Fill her up.
You're listening to the Gas Digital Network.
What up, what up, what up, and welcome to the 100th episode of No Fucking Regrets. 100 episodes. Get the fuck out of here. Yeah, we got there. Just under 2 years. Like a year and 8 months or something. Got to 100. Feel pretty good about that. Consistently dropping them every week. I've only missed a handful of weeks in almost 2 years. So, yeah, man. Episode 100. And I ended last week's episode, number 99, by saying how grateful I am for all the people that been listening, man. Been kicking it with me all this time. Been checking them out. You know, sometimes sometimes it's about the guest, and I get that, you know, but other times, you know, like that remembering Joey Jordison, dude, that was a fucking huge episode, and that was just me fucking rambling, Robb rambling. So, but yeah, to everybody who's been enjoying these and hanging out and kicking it for 100 episodes, man, thank you very much. For everybody who writes in, everybody who comments in the YouTube post, everybody who waits for the fucking, you know, the premiere and then does the live chatting while the fucking podcast is playing. It's rad. It's awesome. I go back and read that shit sometimes. Sometimes I'll even check it out in the moment. I'll just be like, boop, see what people are saying. All right, cool. So, yeah, it feels good to be at number 100. I can't tell you that I ever would have made it to 100. You know, I remember when Ralph Sutton's the guy who runs Gas Digital, and he's like, a lot of people bail after number 16. I don't know what it is. He's like, you get to about number 16 and you're like, if you're going to do it, that's where you're going to stop. And if you go past there, you're going to keep on going. I was like, all right. But he was like, D. Snyder stopped there. Andrew Dice Clay stopped there. 16, boom, done. Like, fuck this. And I get it. You know, I think that, and I mean, I think in D. Snyder's case from Twisted Sister, you know, he's so used to radio. I'm sure it's, I mean, I would imagine it's kind of the same. I don't know. I've never done radio. I don't know. So anyway, here I am, still rocking. Got huge superstar heavy metal guest, Randy Blythe, D. Randall Blythe, on the motherfucking 100th episode. So you know it's going to be a good one. It was pretty cool, man. We got deep, too. I definitely learned some things about him that I had never read or heard him talk about, or, you know, even all the, we've toured together numerous times and done shit tons of festivals, and you know, I learned shit about him during this podcast that I've known the dude for 2003, 18 years. Yeah, I met him in 2003 on the Lamb of God, Chimera, 18 Visions, Atreyu opening tour all across the U.S. They played the Pound in San Francisco, a little 400 cap room. Raging, and we talk about that in the thing, so I don't want to talk about that, but yeah, so I've known him for a long time, and it was cool. You know, I mean, I think when you're partying too, like most of the time we toured with him, he was partying, so like you're never gonna get deep when you're partying. You know, you're just partying, you're hanging out, you're chilling, right, skull biting. I just skull bit the mic. Yes, a lot of skull biting. There was a lot of skull biting back then. That's back when I called myself Skullbiter in Rob Halford voice. I'd bite somebody's fucking skull. Like, Skullbiter. I get the vibrato on there. Ah! I think even the first day that I met him, I gave him a skull bite. And I believe he returned the favor. He was like, hey. Now let me do that to you. Like, all right. So, yeah, we got a good one. We got a good one today, man. And, again, I just want to say thank you for everybody who tunes into these, man. You know, it kind of blows me away that people want to listen to this stuff. And, you know, I listen to podcasts. I listen to, you know, quite a few podcasts. So, you know, but I never listened to them before. Like, you know, I probably started listening to podcasts like 7 or 8 years ago. You know, nothing existed like this before. I guess talk radio, but, you know, I don't know. I never was a big talk radio fan. I got some topics here that I was going to talk about. Podcast topics. Let's see. My youngest son, Wyatt, we've taken him to sushi for most of his life. He's been exposed to it, at least, in many ways. That was a good burp right there. That was my beef and zucchini, tomato, and rice right there. I eat 30 grams of protein, 30 grams of carbs, 10 grams of fat, 6 times a day. So sometimes I eat it with meat and rice. Sometimes it's like my protein shakes. Anyway, that's what I just had. That's what just burped up right there, and it was good. Got lots of Italian herbs. Anyway, my youngest son, Wyatt, never liked sushi. And now that he's 14, he suddenly loves sushi. I don't even know where. I guess he had it on Xander's birthday, my oldest's birthday, back in June. And my oldest's birthday, and he had sushi for the day. He's like, sushi's good. Sushi's good, Dad. So he's like, hey, Dad, can we go to Safeway and get some sushi? I was like, what? it was so out of the blue. I was like, what? He's like, you like sushi now? Like, since when? He's like, I love sushi. I was like, you have hated sushi for 14 years. What are you talking? I've taken you to I don't know how many sushi restaurants. I have not. I was like, yes, you have. But anyway, you like it now. Okay, what do you want to get? He's like, I want to get some California rolls. I'm like, some Safeway? I'm like, all right. You know, there's definitely better California rolls, but, you know, if that's your jam, let's go. So we did, and he got some, and he ate it, and I was like, he loved it. He was like, oh, my God, this is so good. And keep in mind, this is a guy who's not the biggest fan of any fish at all, really, so pretty impressive. And then it got me thinking. I was just impressed that at 14, he's digging sushi. You know, it's pretty cheap at Safeway. It's like $7 or something like that. And so I'm like, I started telling him, like, dude, I didn't have sushi. I don't even think I had sushi till I was like 23. And I started telling him the story, and I totally forgot about this story. But the first time that I ever had sushi, I was dating my manager's daughter. My manager was Debbie Abono, rest her soul, amazing, incredible woman. And she was, you know, just a freaking saint. And I was dating her daughter, and they were big 49er fans. And I was never, you know, like, I was kind of raised a Raiders fan, though I'm not going to be like, I'm the most diehard Raider. Like, I'm not that dude. But so they would always go to the Raider, and I was just like, let's go to a Niner game. Yeah, like, they're like, you want to go to the Niner game? We'll just drink beers. They got, you know, season tickets. So I was like, fuck yeah, let's go. And so as we're going, her older brother Ricky's going with us, and he's a super funny guy, great dude, like, hilarious, big fucking big dude too, like, strong fucking huge tall motherfucker. And he's like, hey, I'm gonna bring a friend. And I was like, all right, cool. We're all going in their van. They got this big, like, kind of family van, and you know, with like a couch in the back and a refrigerator, and like, it's a pretty fucking rad van. Gina and I had sex for the first time in there. The first time we had sex in their family van. Anyway, we're getting ready to, We're getting ready to go, and he's like, "All right, we're gonna go pick up my friend." And we pick him up, and who's his friend? James Hetfield, like from Metallica. And I was like, "Oh shit," you know, because Hetfield's a Raider fan, and I was like, "But him and Ricky were friends, and they'd just go to games together and just loved hanging out." And James was a friend of with the Abonos, and certainly a friend of Debbie's, and was at the house pretty regularly. And so we all went to the game, and I'm sitting there like, fuck, I'm in, you know, this is like, I want to say this is, this might have been before And Justice for All. It was after the Covers album, which is called what? What's the fucking Covers album called? The EP, the 5-song EP that had like the Queen song and, fuck, why am I blanking? Garage Days. And so this is right after Garage Days. And so, you know, Jason just got in the band, Master of Puppets. And we go to the game, and the game's fucking, you know, I don't even remember anything about it. I just remember drinking a ton of beer, got fucking hammered, had a blast. And just trying to be cool around James Hetfield. That's all I was trying to do. I'm just going to try and be cool around James and not make myself look like a dick. that was my main goal. And you know, he's 5 years older than me, so like, you know, I was probably 21 at the time, I guess 23 maybe. I can't remember. But I was relatively, you know, only been with Gina for a short time. And so after the game, we're coming back, and, you know, Hetfield's kind of a prankster. He's like taking, like, they had a bunch of like Cheese Whiz and crackers, and like he takes Ricky's hat, and Ricky's just hammered. Ricky's annihilated. And we're all annihilated. Like, everyone's annihilated except for Debbie. Like, and, you know, just all of us, my girlfriend, James, Ricky. And we're, you know, this is back when James drank. And so he takes off. He's sitting in the back kind of by us. And Ricky's just up front, just hammered, just fucking babbling on. And Hetfield takes his hat off, and he's just like, and he looks over at us, and he grabs the Cheese Whiz. And he just pours a shit ton of Cheese Whiz into the hat. And then he just puts it back on Ricky's head. it was so fucking funny. And he's just like, kind of gives that little like, you know. I'm doing something that shouldn't. Oh my god, it was so fucking funny. And then Debbie's like, "I'm hungry. I want to go get some food." And she's like, "You guys want to go get sushi?" And I guess everyone else had sushi before, so I've never had sushi. And so you know, they order it, and I'm like, I don't even know what to get. I've never had this before. Like, I'm kind of freaked. I'm not the biggest fan of fish. I'm like, but I'm just like, I'm gonna try it because fucking James Hetfield's here, and I'm gonna eat sushi. I'm not gonna puss out in front of James Hetfield on sushi. So they come in, and they order a ton of food. They order, like, you know, gyoza, which I love gyoza, you know, and I loved it from that moment because I was like, oh yeah, this is good. Pork dumplings. And then I think we tried California rolls, which are like fake crab meat with, or maybe real crab meat, like with avocado. And I was like, they got it down. And then they made the little thing for me. You know, they make the sauce. It's like soy sauce with horseradish. And James is like, oh, add more. Add more to the horseradish. And my girlfriend's just like, oh, okay, huh? And they're like laughing. And I'm like, what's so funny? Like, why are we adding more horseradish? They're like, oh no, it's good. It's really good. You know, like, taste it. And like, so of course I taste it, and they're like, no, put a bunch on. Yeah. And it's like, this shit's like as thick as peanut butter right now. And I put it the thing in my mouth, and I'm like, holy shit. You know, it's like that explosion burn in the back of your brain. I was like, oh my fucking God. So, you know, they're like, everybody's laughing. Ah, you know, I'm like, okay. But then I'm like, fuck, that was good. Like, it's, you know, once the heat wears off, like, that's fucking good. So then I tried a bunch, and it was, I don't know. I just told my story to this. I told this story to my son as he's getting the sushi, and he's kind of cracking up. And he's like, who's James Hetfield? I was like, I had sushi with James Hetfield. He's like, who's James Hetfield? I'm like, who's James Hetfield? What? Did I raise? Are you my son? The fuck? Who are you? Like, James Hetfield, Metallica? Hello. Oh, is that the singer from Metallica? I'm like, yeah. He's like, how do I supposed to know his name? I'm like, failure as a father. You don't know James Hetfield's name. So yeah, it was funny. And then at some point during as we're eating sushi, Ricky takes his hat off and he's just like puts his hand on his hair and he's just like, what the fuck is this? And of course we all start just fucking cracking up because this is now him discovering the cheese whiz that Hetfield put in the hat. And he's like, you motherfucker. And he's still drinking. He's still hammered. That was fucking funny. For as far as first sushi experiences go, you know, maybe the best introduction ever. And I remember we went and dropped him off, and I really was just like, God, I just need to get an autograph. This is before cell phones, or this is before cameras. So, like, you know, it's like, just I want to get an autograph. And I was just like, hey, man, can I get an autograph real quick? And he's just like, I'll be right back. And that's all he says. And like, he doesn't say yes, doesn't say no, just says, I'll be right back. I was like, okay. I mean, I didn't say anything. I just went, okay. And, he heads into his apartment. He's living in an apartment, just like a small-ish apartment. It's nothing, you know, you'd think that around this time leading up to And Justice for All, he'd be living in some fabulous mansion. But no, he's just living in some apartment in like El Sobrante or El Cerrito or something. And he comes back and he brings the poster of... What is it? The Pool Fun beer poster. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about, but it's them. I think it's the back of the artwork for Garage Days, but it's them and they're kicking it basically in front of a bar and it says Pool Fun Beer and they're all just kind of lined up against a wall. It's kind of just like a basic shot, but he had a poster of it and he gave me the poster and gave my girlfriend a poster and I was just like, oh dude, I was like, that's fucking awesome. So I put that on my wall and I had a Metallica poster from James. And so that's my first sushi. That's my first sushi. First sushi thing. Just so everybody knows too. If you didn't know, and there's going to be a mid-roll ad halfway through the thing, but Machine Head, all of our merchandise is developed and created and owned and fulfilled and supplied by us. We own our merchandise. We own our publishing. We're a completely DIY entity and we partner with people to help us out. But you know, at the end of the day, this is Machine Head running the show. And about 4 years ago, we got the rights back to all of our merchandise. And at that time I made the decision. I was like, we had been with a bunch of big companies and small companies and everything in between. And I was like, you know, for the online shit, for the tour shit, like, I just want to do this ourselves. Like, I'm tired of fucking just dealing with fucking people and, like, seeing them. You know, we're making $1,000 every 4 months from online sales. I'm like, no, this ain't fucking right. And so about 4 years ago, we started 10 Ton Trading Company, which is the official merchandise web store for Machine Head. And, yeah, we got some super, I just wanted to make super premium shit. You know, like I'm kind of a prima donna when it comes to t-shirts. I want them to fit a certain way. I want them to feel a certain way. Like most rock shirts are kind of, they're weird and boxy and they're fucking itchy and I like them. So I was like, you know, fucking we're doing this ourselves. Like I want some premium shit. So, you know, we sourced, I don't know, probably like 30 different t-shirts and narrowed it down to this one that I loved. And, you know, we sourced all these different hoodies, probably 10 different hoodies and narrowed it down to this one that's just super premium. It costs more, but tell you what, we've got 5, 6, you know, print placements on like, look at this t-shirt right here. Got 2 arm prints, front, oversized back, neck label, tag torn out. You know, it's a premium product. And so, right now, we're going to be having, when this drops, it's going to be the 10-year anniversary of Locust coming up here in a couple of days. And so we're doing a full album playthrough on the Machine Head Facebook, YouTube, and Twitch. But we're also going to be having we're going to be dropping 2 new Locust-related shirts that are all brand new artwork that turned out sick. They're awesome. And we're going to be having an end-of-summer sale. And so... everybody on my podcast, everybody listening to the podcast, if you head over and use the code no fucking regrets, you're going to get an extra 15% off of anything at 10 Ton Trading Company. And that's going to be in addition to the sale that's going on right now. So there's going to be a bunch of select items on sale for the end of summer sale, because it's the end of summer. I think it's today or tomorrow or something. I think it's Wednesday maybe. Fucking, I was like, really? Summer's over? Like, it's officially over. Some people look at Labor Day as the officially last day, but, you know, now it's officially over. So we're having an end of summer sale. And we got a new drop going for the Locust stuff. And then, yeah, head over there and check it out, man. You'll get 15% off. Enter the code fucking regrets, and save 15% for all my loyal listeners and everybody who's subscribed on the YouTube and all that shit, man. Should I talk a little bit more? Let's see. I don't know if I should talk about this next thing. Corey Taylor and Machine Gun Kelly are beefing. I was on Twitch yesterday. There's a girl on Twitch who does ASMR, which I'm sure most of you know what it is, but it's basically like people go onto a microphone and they talk like this, and then they go, oh, you know. There's this chick. I want to say her name's Amaranth, like Amore. That's Amore. Amaranth, like love, I guess, and jewelry. Anyway, this chick, and she's fucking like, don't get it twit, like she's hot. Like she's fucking redhead. I'm a sucker for redheads too. I was like, oh my God. She's hot. She's wearing nothing but a bra on Twitch. And she's basically, yesterday, she's like offering like, for $25, she'll lick the mic. And let me tell you, there's 15,000 people, dudes, I'm assuming, like on fucking watching her. Basically, she's got this thing. I don't even know what it was, but it's, you know, it's all like in headphones. So she has this thing where she's rubbing her hand from the left to the right over this round thing that I'm assuming is making the sound go left and right. And then she's on the microphone, literally just going, just, I mean, essentially, you know, pretending to perform fellatio. Fucking, you know, and she's hot and she's wearing a bra and her fucking tits are all boo. And like, all the dudes are just like, oh, there's so many. I was just reading the comments because it's just such a fascinating fucking time and I'm in the world. But when we sit there and just watch a girl for literally 2 hours, 2 hours just licking on a microphone and whispering, I'm going to read a book right now. And you know, and he's just licking. And the guy's like, oh my God, your eye contact is amazing. Your eye contact is amazing. Like, this motherfucker is so fantasizing his dick right in her mouth. God, I was just like, oh my God, that's what we've come to. That's where we're at in the world. And I don't know if this chick's fucking thing started in I don't know if it started, you know, before the pandemic or like exploded during the pandemic, but fuck me, like, good for you, girl. And mother, she's got a hell of subscribers. Motherfuckers are throwing down $25 every few seconds just to continue the licking. I mean, her tongue is bionic. I mean, she's got to have, I mean, she's literally licked a microphone for fucking, you know, I went away for an hour and a half, came back, she was still licking the microphone. Anyway, it's a crazy world. Crazy world. I'm not going to go into the, I don't, I'm going to stay out of the Corey. I read a quote the other day, like this lady, she lived to be 100. They're like, what's the secret to a long life? She's like, staying out of motherfuckers' business. I'm going to stay out of motherfuckers' business. I got Randy Blythe. Check this out. I'm going to play this one song. If you've never heard Lamb of God, this is the only song that you need to hear. Because this next riff coming up is the fucking riff, bro. And I don't think I'm hoping I'm not going to get a copyright strike, because this is one of the records that's not on, it's one of the records that's not on Epic. So this is from As the Palaces Burn when they were on Prosthetic. But this jam right here, this is the shit. Love this shit.
Destroyer of senses,
when it kicks into this next riff, get the fuck out of here. Right here. Sick, bro. Fucking sick. Get the fuck out of here with that riff. And then they just let it ride. So good. And then they break, and then here comes the next one. Right there. And then it goes back into it, but the slower version. Oh, not yet. This whole section. It's like five sick ass riffs. It's just the end of the song. There it is. Yeah, motherfuckers, yeah. Check that shit out. Go listen to that whole record. As the Palaces Burns, a banger. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, this is my privilege and my honor for the 100th episode of No Fucking Regrets to bring you the mighty, mighty D. Randall Blythe, Lamb of God. Randy Blythe.
How you doing?
What's up, man?
All right, man.
You're like this.
Okay. I'm doing it from my phone because there's nowhere quiet.
Can you do it sideways so that you're... There you go.
Does that work?
Yeah, that works. Yeah, you were awesome. Like, you were wide, but sideways.
But the other way?
Yeah.
Now, there's nowhere quiet, like, with Wi-Fi that I could get on my computer to do this, and I'm going to do it in the fucking phone because we're in Jersey today.
Oh, shit. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
This is the big, this is the, like, the New York play?
No. Jones Beach was the New York play. This is,
This is, like, Philly?
No, that was yesterday. That was... This is, you've played here before, PNC.
Yeah.
Jersey. It's like, I don't know, Jersey. If people will come down from New York or whatever.
Yeah.
But we played on Long Island on Jones Beach the other day. It's a good All show. Right.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Yeah.
What's been the best show of the tour? Not to shit on any other city in America, but who brought it hard?
I mean, like, you go to a place like Reno, Nevada, you know, where it wasn't the biggest show, it wasn't the greatest venue, but they're going apeshit out there.
Starving.
Yeah. So, you know how it is. I mean, it's hard for me to qualify, like, hey, what's the best show of the tour, you know, but, I remember Reno was really good as far as audience response.
So Reno was your number one so far?
That's really...
Wild. I know.
It's really hard to say. Yeah. You know?
I mean, it seems like the tour's been killing it, dude. Like, fucking slaying.
Yeah, it has been. People are definitely wanting to see some music, you know.
I was texting, you and I were texting, and I was just looking at your Instagram about your awesome, awesome Instagram post right before the tour started. Like, get fucking vaccinated. Like, just stop.
Yes.
You fucking laid it down so good, dude. I was like, it was awesome. It was awesome to hear. It was awesome.
Well, dude. I think some people, like, I believe in fucking science, right? And I have friends who are doctors and scientists and nurses. And these are the people I'm going to listen to. Not someone on social media, not another musician, not a talking head on CNN, Fox News, USA Today, PBS, none of this stuff.
Not a podcaster.
not me and you, Rob. Right. Not me and you.
Oh, don't listen to me.
Right. And don't listen to me. I talk to my friends who are molecular biologists, immunologists, emergency room doctors, and I have friends who are nurses, and one of whom works in a COVID ward. Oh, you know?
Yeah. Wow.
Yes. Yes. And someone very close to me. These are not my friends, neighbors, second cousin, buddy. I heard this or that or the other. These are people who are friends of mine. I talk to directly. They're like, this is real. This is the science. This is the data. This is what I see. These are the people I see dying.
Right.
So I'm going to listen to my friends, you know, because they're a lot smarter than me. You know, and unless
I'm impressed with how many that you know, biologists and all these people, you know,
of course, man, yeah. You know, and for me, you know, everybody has to quote unquote do their own research, I guess. Yeah. My research involves talking to friends of mine who right. spent years of their lives. Pursuing degrees that cost them thousands and thousands of dollars, you know, or who dedicate their lives to the service of others in the medical profession. And these are what these people are telling me. So I'm not listening to, I don't have to make this sort of, I don't have to filter through all this data, through all these different media sources. I just talk to my friends, you know, are you vaccinated? Yes. Tell me about this vaccine. Tell me about the technology. And I've had these conversations because, you know, when the vaccine came out very rapidly, like anyone else, comparatively, like anyone else, I was like, well, that's quick. But then some friends of mine explained to me, like, this is old technology. They've been working on this right. for 15 fucking years. Right. It's not new. So cut it out with that. And also, this is not just, an American or one country or one corporation's push. This is like a massive international effort to get this vaccine ready, different ones ready for distribution. I have a friend who works in intelligence, pretty high level intelligence, and one of their jobs right now is helping out with COVAX, which is the international vaccine distribution arm. You know, he is talking to one of his coworkers from COVAX who is just like, you know, it's very frustrating with certain places where, you know, the vaccine is available and people don't want to take it when there are countries that are begging for it.
Right.
You know,
dude.
When there's people, you know. So all that aside, like all that aside, for me, it like I said, it's a matter of talking to my friends and being like, what's the deal with this? Because these are people I trust, you know, and they're a lot smarter than me. And you, Rob, they're a lot smarter than either of us. So I'm going to listen to them, you know, I'm just gonna.
Yeah. Yeah. It's awesome. You know? I'm, you know, and there's a lot of people that are out there that have friends, you know, I've got, you know, people who work with the CDC and I know them and they're just like, dude, get the vaccine. Like, I'm like,
yes,
they break it down for me. This is safe. This is, you know, same thing you were saying. And, you know, I wish everybody had those kind of friends.
Right. Well, here's the other thing is I'm not going to deny at all. And I'm sure someone was going to all, this whole thing is going to be clickbait. We know this already,
yeah, right.
This podcast. So everybody that's pulling this for clickbait, fuck yourself, okay?
All the aggregators. Listen to the
all the aggregators, go fuck yourself first and foremost right now. This is a long form conversation and you can pull all the clickbait you want, but unless you're willing to listen to this and understand what we're saying, then what you're doing is fucking useless. So suck my dick, all right? Because these people annoy me. But and I forgot what I was saying because,
you know, to me though, the thing that the reason I brought that up is just, you know, and I texted you cause I was like, dude, that was fucking amazing. And I was just so stoked that you did it. And I, you know, knowing full well that you were going to get a fucking tsunami of shit for saying what you said, you know? And I was for you, Randy, like good for you.
But I do not give a fuck. I do not give a fuck. It is our responsibility as human beings to speak the truth as we know it. And that doesn't mean I have to get in an online argument. First of all, I don't argue online. I don't give a fuck, dude. I'm just not going to do it. That's, you know, it's pointless. It's right. pointless. I will have individual conversations with people.
In the thread?
Because, no, I don't argue online.
Yeah.
I like talk you to might... motherfuckers. I refuse to do that. I refuse to engage in combative situations in an online environment. It's stupid. It's moronic, because there's this filter that it puts it between the two people who are having a talk. You know, there's like this remove, you know what I mean? And I have friends who are very staunchly anti-vaccine.
Yeah.
Who are
same here.
on the opposite, like, political spectrum as I am, you know, and first, let's get one thing straight. I am not pro any political party. Fuck them all. You know what I mean? But I will have a conversation face to face with anyone, and it doesn't degenerate into stupid name calling.
Right.
And then talking over each other, which is all that is. It's on online argument. That's all it is. It's a bunch of people trying to talk over each other. I'm willing to talk to anyone as a reasonable human being. You know what I mean?
Face to face.
Face to face. Yes. Yeah. You know, if you are a reasonable human being, because I believe, you know, not that you should try and change people's minds, but if you want to reach some sort of common ground, you need to have interpersonal conversations, like in person, you know, because another thing with the online thing is people split into camps, and everything is so polarized right now, and it is impossible to come to any sort of clear understanding of another person's views online when it's just one group against the other. You know, there's nuance in conversation. There's nuance in one-on-one interactions. You know, Frank Zappa famously said, "Computers don't have eyebrows." Right?
That's good. I've never heard that. That's so good, yeah, right? Like,
yeah,
so much expression happens in an eyebrow, right?
Like, yeah. The problem with computers is that they don't have eyebrows. I can't. You know, I can't feel empathy or come to any sort of understanding with another person through online arguing. It's stupid. It's ridiculous, you know? And, you know, a reason why I made that statement on my Instagram is in case anyone, I'm not trying to convince anyone to go get vaccinated or whatever. Basically, I put out there, the main crux of it is if someone was considering whether or not to bring a mask to a show, I'd be like, this is what I would do. You know, I'm wearing a mask backstage. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's, dude, don't give me that you can't breathe and it's hurting your fucking, all of that is just fucking stupid, man. Right, yeah. Doctors have been wearing masks for decades and decades and decades and decades.
Yeah.
Not just to protect themselves, but to protect the patient when they do an operation, you know, to prevent microbes from getting into an open wound while they're operating on someone. You know, it's common sense, man. It's common sense.
I mean, so, dude, when I was a kid, I used to wear a mask all the time just for fun. You know, like, because I was a total science fiction nerd. And like, I was like, I want to wear a mask all the time. I love it.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, dude, you and I have friends who've made careers out of wearing masks. So.
Right. Totally. I know. Go be Slipknot in 106 degree weather and then complain about fucking masks. All right.
Dude, that's it. It's like, dude, go be Slipknot. Go be Gwar. Wear all that shit. You
totally.
Know? It's like, you can't wear a little fucking mask, dude. Don't be a pussy. Jesus Christ. You know?
Made a decades long career out of wearing a full mask. Not even like this little, just a mouth thing, like a full latex.
Yeah.
Pat, you know.
Yeah. I sent Corey Taylor a message the other day because I saw a picture of his new mask and it looks like it's just two little tiny holes.
Tiny
I'm like, how the fuck do you see out of that thing? Your peripheral vision must be shot, bro. And he's like, I just keep turning my head. You know?
Yeah, I do hear you. But I, you know, I wanted to just give you some props. I don't know if anybody else gave you props, but I feel like you absolutely deserve some props for that, man. It was fucking rad. Man, and the way you wrote it was really, you know, you weren't judgmental. You weren't having a go at people. You weren't like, fuck anti-vax. You know, like you just, the way, it was just so well written and it was just fucking on point, dude.
Well, it's because I'm not trying to, once again, be like, you're a fucking dummy for not wearing a mask or not getting vaccinated, because that does no good. That's just more of this like separation thing. And like I was went off about the aggregators right now. I'm sure they're gonna pick something, and that's just a bunch of fucking people are gonna read a click on and they're gonna be like, well, fuck you too. But guess what? I'm not gonna know about it. You know why? Because I'm not gonna read any of those articles because I don't fucking care. Right. Like, and that's the other thing about the whole online thing. This shit does not affect me, dude, because I stopped looking at it a long time ago.
Yeah.
Therefore, it's not in my reality. So it has zero effect on me. You know what I mean?
I feel like that's someplace that you kind of have gotten to, though, recently. Like, I remember there was a time when you were posting and then you stopped letting people comment. And I think you turned your Instagram off for a while, right? Like,
yeah, what I did now. You're going
through a love-hate relation with social media, as we all do.
I quit Twitter because all I did was argue with people.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because they would just say like the most ridiculous things to me, inappropriate things, like sometimes even just like ball busting. And it's like, yo, no, my friends can bust my balls. We're friends. I'm a human fucking being, dude. You know, I don't treat anyone with disrespect. Nobody, whether it's online or in person, as long as, you know, they present themselves. I'm not interested in disrespecting people. It's weak. It's pathetic. That's why like the online trolls and all that shit. It's like, you're a pathetic fucking human being if that's what you do. And you're only, and the other thing is, you're only harming yourself in the end, because that's your way of processing your insecurities, right? And if you're constantly acting out like that, and that's the way you express your insecurities in an attempt to make your pathetic self feel better by putting someone else down, that's only making your internal emotional landscape worse. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So deal with shit in reality. If you're like trolling online, it's bad for you. Yeah. You know, it really is. It's toxic. Bad for that person. Yeah, it's toxic. So on my Instagram, I only people I follow can comment. And it wasn't politics that did this. It wasn't the you suck, because I use my Instagram for photography.
Oh, you have a private account?
No. Oh, okay. It's open, but only people I follow can comment.
Oh,
right?
I didn't know that.
But, yeah. And because my friends, some of whom I disagree with, are not going to say moronic things. So like people would, the reason why I did that is because people would argue amongst themselves on my Instagram. They would turn it into like this battlefield place to argue over things. You know what I mean? And I suppose I posted a picture of a landscape, of a Canadian landscape with snow on it or something. People would find a way to argue, right? And insult each other. So I'm like, you know what? I'm not going to provide a forum for that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm not going to provide.
I'm seriously thinking, like, as you're telling this story, I'm like, I need to do this. This is I didn't even know you could do that. That's fucking awesome.
Yeah. You could just put like only your followers can comment, because only the people you follow can comment, because I'm, you know, and I follow people that I have disagreements with, but they aren't going to be childish and argue with people online. It's just toxic, toxic, toxic shit. And then I'm sure some people are like, well, you don't believe in free speech. Nope, not on my Instagram. I don't. Guess what? My Instagram is not America. This is not America. This is Randy's digital house, right? I don't let you walk into my real house and start talking shit and arguing and insulting me.
It's
and all that
Randerica.
It's Randonesia, motherfucker. And guess what? It is a monarchy. I am the fucking king. I run this bitch. Right. So go suck my dick. You don't get to come up into Randonesia and start running your mouth a bunch of negative shit, because that's not how we roll.
I mean, that's a good parallel you drawing there with, I don't let you come to my house and start a big argument.
Why would I, you know, it has nothing to do with free speech. You know, you're free to walk down the street in your town in like Kalamazoo, Michigan or whatever, with a big sign that says Lamb of God sucks. Their singer is fucking the worst thing to happen to heavy metal since whatever. You know, you can parade down the street. You can protest me all you want. That's
America. He can go on his own Instagram and
do that. You can go on your own, but you don't come to my house and do that. So I have the ability, and I just don't, once again, it's like, why would I provide a forum for idiocy? Why would I do that if I don't have to, you know? It's, my life is way better. And people actually comment, once again, on the photos, because my Instagram is about photography. I am a photographer. I am not about, you know, your political views, your views on science, your views on which Iron Maiden record is the best. I don't fucking care. You know what I mean? Go away. Argue that in your world. There's plenty of space in your world for that.
I was talking to a buddy of mine, and we were, you know, talking about the pros and cons of social media, and it does have many cons, you know, like being able to have
I'm this far from getting off of it at all times, even with, totally. Even with my fucking removal, like I'm this far. I'm just so far, just too lazy to build my own website for photography, because that's all I use it for. But I also use my Instagram for charitable things. Yeah. I raise
there's so many people that are seeing your stuff and just enjoying it, seeing your photography, enjoying your photography, liking it, and then never commenting, and probably never will ever comment. You know, they're just like voyeuring into your life. That's probably 90% of your followers. You know, they don't care about saying anything good or bad. They enjoy it and they just go, oh, cool. You know, like, whatever. Hey, everyone, let's take a quick break for a word from our sponsor. If you did not know, Machine Head owns and operates 10 Ton Trading Company, the official merchandise company for the band. We make the designs, we source out all of the materials, get our friends and local businesses to print it all up. It is fulfilled by us. Everything is 100% DIY. So if you're buying from Machine Head, that money is going directly to us. It's not going to some big corporate merchandise company who's taken a gigantic cut of it. No, this is going right to us, and it helps support everything we do and has certainly been, you know, amazing during the pandemic. So for all the people that have been loyal subscribers here on No Fucking Regrets, if you head over to 10tontradingco.com right now and enter the code No Fucking IN Regrets, you'll get 15% off. That's No Fucking Regrets for 15% off of the entire store. And if you're listening in the week of release, we're having a end of summer sale, as well as dropping some new items that are pertinent to the Unto the Locust record. So head over there, check it out one more time. No Fucking Regrets for 15% off store wide. And that's for being a loyal subscriber and listener here to the podcast. Anyway, let's get back to the show.
That's the other thing. I talked to a friend of mine who's talking about this online thing. Like, there's the perception of everyone is at each other's throats and arguing online, but it's only the people who choose to do that. They're choosing to do that and argue online. There's a whole bunch of other people who are just like, I don't fucking care.
Yeah, the majority.
Yeah. And you won't know that because they don't fucking care and they're not doing it, you know?
Yeah. But he was saying that it's, and that's what I do. You know, I do feel like there's that good part of it, you know, and it's like the silent majority that isn't saying anything.
Right.
And so you don't get that feedback. The only feedback, you know, most of the feedback is either uber positive or uber negative.
Right.
And, you know, and that's still a minority, but that He was saying he had a theory that, like, we've reached this kind of time now in social media where the most fucking crazy, the person who screams out the craziest shit and is there, you know, wakes up and starts Instagram live in, and then, you know, has 50 stories going on and 10 posts and then another Instagram live, like, that person is rewarded, you know, like, for their complete, you know, just need to be on social media. And the more crazy right. shit that they say, the higher they get in the algorithm, the more followers they get, the more likes they get. And that, like, social media encourages this fucking absurd behavior.
Yes.
And it is. It's like it rewards the stupidest shit you say. Now you're going to get up in the fucking search engine or whatever.
Right.
Yeah.
And how
toxic that is for the world, you know, not just for, you know, for the world.
Yeah. Social media, I've used it for some really good purposes, which is, you know, one reason why I haven't gotten off of it is because I've used it for different charities. I've used it to raise money for, like, breast cancer research. I've used it. There are ways to use it in a positive way, right? And it's also, with my photography, it's helped me, like, work on it and see the progression of it. Because if you look at the very first photos I took when I just had a cell phone until now, you can see the sort of progression. And it's also, for me, a sort of diary of sorts. Because, you know, I shoot wherever I am, and I'm like, what year were we playing in Holland, you know, when this and this and that, how I can just look on there, you know. So right. there's some positive things to it, but there are a lot of negative things to it, and it is addictively designed purposely for, you know, it's purposely designed for that serotonin hit, the likes, blah, 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 you know, these comments. And
notifications.
Yeah, I have all my notifications turned off.
All off. Yeah.
Fuck no, I can't be ba-ding, ba-ding, ba-ding.
It's insane.
So, no way, dude.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's a business tool, and I use it for charitable purposes because I have used it as a business tool to promote different things, like the clothing line I'm involved with, Sun Cult. Yep. I've used it to promote photography exhibits that I've had, you know, and promote like a book. My management has to beg me to post anything about Lamb of God. They have to beg me. They're like, please, because
they're like, you're promoting your t-shirt but not your album.
Yeah, exactly. They hate it, you know, but it's like, because I want,
why is that, why don't you want to, do you just feel like what's the deal with that?
Because it's kind of like I am more than just a singer of Lamb of God.
Okay.
You know, and I take photography very seriously and I take writing very seriously. So I kind of like draw a separation. And as far as Lamb of God shit, there's a Lamb of God Instagram. We have a million followers.
Right, right.
You know, right. And somebody handles that. I don't handle that. So like. There's someone else. Yeah, that, like,
if you don't know a new Lamb of God record's coming out,
yeah, exactly.
Follow me, right? Okay,
and I get it. I also, like, it's just strange, man. Like, I have a hard time kind of promoting. It's hard enough promoting my photography or writing in a sense. I'm not a good salesman. You know what I mean? And I've always been that way about music, with our music. I'm not like, hey, please check out our music. You know, I'm kind of like, do it if you want. I don't fucking care if you don't, you know, like, yeah. you like it, you don't. So I'm a terrible salesperson. I'm a terrible salesman. If I had to go door to door to sell something, I'd be homeless.
Yeah.
You know, straight up. I'm not good at it.
But I mean, sharing your music, you know, that is art that you created, and it's lyrics you wrote, and it's, you know, a passionate performance about something you cared about put into it. So,
yeah, it's just like I'm trying to create a sort of a separation.
Space. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm trying to have some space within from in my life where I'm not the dude from Lamb of God.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Or I'm more than just the dude from Lamb of God. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. No, I'm always going to be the dude from Lamb of God. Yes. Yeah. But I accept that. Yeah. Like, you know, till the day I die. It's cool.
It could be worse.
It could be a whole lot worse. You know, I'm not complaining. I love being in this band, dude. Yeah. You know? But I am trying to carve out like something different. It's just, it's not the totality of my identity. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, I think that's cool. I think that's, you know, I dig it now. I mean, I never even questioned it. Just when you said that, I was just like, oh, what's that about? You know, but like, I kind of got, you know, like the fact that I think you've got one of the most interesting Instagrams because you aren't constantly posting about yourself. You know, it's not just the fucking, you know, there's seriously some band dudes out there. Their whole Instagram page is selfies of them going, you know, and it's like, what the fuck? I'm never going to, I could give a shit about what you're doing. Like you've got surfing, you've got, you know, things that you care about, activism in some ways, you know, like you know, pictures of the Robert E. Lee statue getting taken down in Virginia, you know, shit like that. Like, it's like, it's fucking, it's interesting.
Right. So, I mean, like, I do not blame anyone who is a musician or a writer or an artist or whatever, who, if that is their business tool, if Instagram is their business tool to promote that particular part of their career, then okay, cool. That's smart business for them to do, like, hey, here's me making a stupid face with Kerry King. You know, I mean, and those, or you, you know, I mean, those photos are fun. It's fun, you know,
totally.
Like, here's me, you know, making a goofy face backstage at the gig tonight, because fans want to see that shit. Right.
Yeah.
And I get that.
And it's maybe a fun moment that you had in your life and you wanted to share it.
Right. And I get that, but like, that's not how I do things. And for my Instagram, because once again, it's not about Lamb of God. It even says it in the bio, my photographs, not my music.
Okay.
You know, so, but that also being said, you know, Bubble, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, Bubble had, awesome. Bubble had a, as far as the selfie thing, right? I saw on this tour, we were in Vegas on a day off, and they have a selfie museum there, which made me want to shoot myself. And I saw that, like, design, right? I'm just like, oh my God, it just makes me want to kill myself. Bubble explained, like, once he went back to the concept of my Instagram as sort of my digital house, right? Bubble put it like this. He's like, I think of my Instagram account as sort of my online house, right? So think about it this way. If you walked into someone's real house and all you saw everywhere on the wall was pictures they had taken of themselves, like covering every inch of space, you would think, what a fucking asshole, right?
No, you'd be like, what the fuck? What the
right?
fuck did I just walk into?
Who is this egotistical asshole? You know what I mean?
Right. And I don't think, like, I have a single picture. I know we've got a couple of family pictures in like the hallway.
Right.
And I'm trying to think, like, if I have pictures in my house of myself.
Dude, I don't even have, there is not one single thing in my house. If people walked in and looked around, they'd be like, oh, this guy, he's a weirdo, but they would never know I was in Lamb of God.
Right.
There's nothing that says I'm in Lamb of God. There's no pictures of me. There's no gold records. There's no none of that. So, I mean, no offense to anybody who does that, because I, you know, people do that and it's cool. To me, it's just like, I've been doing this for 27 years, I guess, 26, 27 years. I don't need a reminder that I am in Lamb of God. Right. I just don't. I know I'm in Lamb of God. Yeah, it's cool.
Like, I'm trying to get away. You're like, I'm trying to get away from Lamb of God.
Right. Yeah, exactly. You know, I'm home now.
I'm trying to decompress from Lamb of God.
I'm home. I want to go surfing, man. Oh. You know, I want to read. I want to, you know, do my nerdy shit, because I'm just a big nerd, you know?
You don't have any pictures of you surfing or anything like that, like, in your house?
Not one.
Okay.
Not one.
Yeah, I've got pictures of me wakeboarding. Like, I got pictures like family, like lake.
Yeah, you know, dude,
camping,
if there,
camping
if
on
I,
the lake and shit like that.
If I ever get a cool photo of me like deep in the barrel surfing, then I will print that and frame that and put it up, because it's not just like, oh, look at me ripping and surfing. Like, if it's a really good wave, I'll look at it and remember it, because I can remember specific waves from like 7 years ago. The ride only, yeah, like the ride only lasted like 6 seconds, but it was epic, and right. I can still see it and remember it. So if I ever get a photo of me, excuse me, like deep in a barrel,
He's got the COVID.
No, I don't.
His balls are swollen.
I'm not pregnant yet. I've been testing a lot. If I ever get a picture of me deep in the barrel, just shacked, chilling in the green room, I'll print that big and frame it up, because I'll look at it and be like, that was an awesome wave.
Yeah.
You know, because that brings me internal happiness.
Yeah. And that'd be a fucking cool picture.
Yeah.
Yeah. Something you don't see every day.
No, not at all. And I'm still trying to come out of a barrel. I've never come out of a barrel surfing. I've been in one or two, but I'm an entirely average surfer at best. You know what I mean? I'm never gonna surf Pipeline. I'm never gonna surf fucking Jaws or any of those massive waves. You know, I'm just not gonna do it. I'm an old man. I like cruising. It's cool. It brings me happiness.
Yeah, it's very peaceful out there. It's like a lot of discipline. You know,
it's not necessarily competitive.
Yeah, I was gonna say it's not competitive.
No,
like it's very like
it's not competitive at all, dude. It's just like chilling. And like, one thing I love about surfing is like, it's like I've been in the lineup before, literally with people aged 75 to like,
wow,
six.
75 and surfing, that's fucking rad.
Oh yeah, man. And I've been like, how old are you, dude? 75. Look over there, and there's like my buddy's 6-year-old kid out there surfing with us. And it's one of the few sports that, and I don't really like to call it a sport, because it's not. I mean, it is for the people that compete, but for most of us, it's just something we do. It's one of the few, like, sort of, we'll call it a sport just for convenience, that you can do with people of all ages, and it's not weird, you know? Like, it'd be weird if I was like, I'm going to go play flag football with a 75-year-old man and a 6-year-old. That'd be fucking weird. You know what I mean?
Right.
But it's not weird in surfing. It's just chill. It's about like, and also you get really excited for other people when they catch a good wave. It's not competitive. Like when I'm with my friends and we're surfing, I get so excited if I see my buddy catch a really good wave, just as excited as when I do. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, I've gone surfing a couple times, and it's challenging, man. I thought I would be. I'm a big wakeboarder. I've been really into wakeboarding for a good 20 plus years now.
Yeah,
but it's not like, it's so different from that. You know, like,
yes,
I thought I was good with the balance. Like once I got up, I was good. It was the whole getting up.
Like, that's the big part.
Yeah,
that's the big part of it. Getting up. You know.
Yeah.
Like wakeboarding is pretty fun. We used to do it. Every now and then behind like Willie's dad used to live at this lake out in Virginia. And every now and then we'd go out there and they had a pontoon boat, not even like a fast boat, but we'd wakeboard behind
the pontoon.
Yeah. Like really slow wakeboarding, you know, it was fun though, man.
Yeah. Nice. I just wake surf now. That's what I've been kind of like the wake surf.
I haven't tried that yet. That's where you drop the rope.
Oh, yeah, drop the rope and you can get a pretty big weight. You go pretty slow. You put like a little thing in the water to kind of make
it. Yeah, it lowers the back of the boat, right?
Yeah. I don't know if you'd like it, you know, like I think that, you know, it's you know, some of the wildness of the ocean is lost. You know what I mean?
Right.
And I think that that's a big draw for people who surf, is that, you know, the kind of unpredictability of, you know, any of it, you know, like there's a slight sense of danger in there as well.
Yes, at all times.
In the ocean.
The ocean will kill you.
Fucking kick your ass.
it will kill you. You cannot fight the ocean. You have to learn to work with the ocean, you know? And that's why, like, being a coastal kid my whole life, you know, every summer, some big muscular bound tough guy fucking from inland comes out there and drowns because he goes out there and he's like swimming and then gets caught in a rip current, or it's always like rip current warnings, and the tourists go swimming, you know, when they aren't supposed to. And some beefy guy thinks like, you know, oh, I'm tough, I can paddle, I can swim out of this. No, dude, not if you don't know what you're doing, you know? So they like fight against the rip current instead of swimming sideways out of it, letting it just take them. They fight against it and they drown. It happens every year, you know? So, and I mean, it happens to even people who are really good watermen. So there is an element of danger to it. You have to respect the ocean.
Yeah. You know? I mean, the thing that's cool about wake surfing is you can just cruise for like 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Like if you're, you know, good enough, like I've had runs where I was like fucking rolling for 10 minutes and I was like, this is awesome. You know, and you
I don't know anybody who does it. So maybe you can take me wake surfing sometime.
I'd love to take you. It'd be fun. It's a blast.
Yeah, dude, I'd love to try it.
Yeah.
I'll do anything once.
Yeah. Yeah. You can't have a bad time on the lake. You know what I mean? Like
it's hard. It's hard for me to have a bad time on the water, no matter what.
Yeah.
Whether it's the ocean, the lake, a river, a fucking lagoon, anything, dude. As long as I'm near water, I'm happy. I'm a big time water guy.
Yeah. I hear you. Especially when Machine Head's stressing me out, like going out and on the wakeboard and just fucking clears my head and just, you know. Tell me about you and Dez got a merch company, Sun Cult.
Yeah.
How did that come about?
Well, Dez,
that was a friendship I was kind of surprised that happened. Like, I don't recall. I mean, maybe because of Devil Driver, you know, like Devil Driver.
Yeah, it's because of Devil Driver. Yeah. Because we met touring Devil Driver.
Dez is awesome. I love Dez.
Yeah. I started surfing, and because I've only been surfing since I was like, I've been skateboarder my whole life, right? And it hurts too much really now. Like, I have a torn meniscus from Slayer Tour a few years ago because I was still skateboarding. But I started surfing in my 40s. I think I was like 42 or 3 when I started surfing. Maybe 43. Dez, I was starting to, I put up a few pictures of me surfing or whatever. And Dez was like, oh, you surf? We got to go surfing together. And so I wound up surfing with him, you know, and out in Southern California a lot, Orange County area. And he had started a clothing company with his wife, Anastasia. You know Anastasia?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she's great.
Called Sun Cult. And I was just wearing their shit on stage. And you know, they're hanging out with them surfing a lot. And one day they're like, hey, dude, we talked and like, we want to know, do you want to be a part of Sun Cult? And I'm like, I thought I already was, kind of. So like, they're like, you know, I started coming up with some designs for them. Mostly it's like creative type shit. Like I came up with this design of Dracula surfing. Dracula, because I'm a big vampire type guy, you know.
Nice.
He's surfing. He's hanging 10 on a longboard with a victim in his arms, you know. And it's daywalkers because those are what you call vampires. You can go out during the day, and he's walking the nose. And I came up with another. I had this idea for a T-shirt that I'd had ideas for a tattoo since I was in my 20s, and it's a black flag bars, but instead of the bars, they're tiki glasses.
Okay.
And it's like the black flag song TV party.
Yeah.
TV party tonight. It's tiki party tonight. Yeah. So we made that. You know, just hanging out with them and like kind of like kicking ideas around. And that's how that's it. And you know, we're in Zoomies now, which is kind of interesting, doing some runs.
That's fucking awesome. Yeah. That's big shit right there, dude.
Yeah, we're not in all Zoomies stores. We're still kind of testing. We're in like the third market, but like we're available in the online Zoomies stores. There's some like exclusive shirts that you can only get at Zoomies, but you know, we're just constantly working on new designs and like putting it out there. And it's really just a fun thing that started as a business a family business for Dez and his wife. And, you know, now his son Caleb is really involved in it as well. So, you know, it's cool, you know, it's not about our bands. Once again, it's about surfing for us, you know, that's how it started.
And being creative with, you know, making designs and stuff.
Yeah. 100%. Yeah. Like, so yeah, I come up with design concepts. I'm not saying I draw those. Like, I draw them like in my pathetic artistic way, give them to a real artist.
Right.
You know?
Yes. Totally. Yeah. Totally. Yeah. Do you do that for Lamb of God? Do you draw some of the designs for like t-shirt designs?
No. Mark Morton handles all the Lamb of God merch.
Okay.
That's his baby, you know, and he handles all of that. He talks to all the designers. I mean, like, every now and then, if there's a, like, most of the time, I don't know what we have on our t-shirts. Like, I have zero idea okay. of what our t-shirts are, because Mark just deals with it, and then we go out on tour, and there's a new shirt.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm like,
so you see it when it's up on the rack
or on someone. I'll be like, oh, where'd you get that shirt? And they're like, from your website. I'm like, I don't know.
You're like, that's cool. I like it.
That's cool. I like it. You know, it's cool. No, I don't deal with any of that, man. Like, that's Mark Stone. You know, that's his baby, and he does it well. And God bless him.
Yeah,
he can have it.
Right. Yeah. No doubt. I had a thought there when you were saying that, and I blanked on it. I fucking brain farted.
That's it's all right.
That's what happens when you're 54. You just brain fart for no reason out of nowhere.
Oh, I know. I'm 50, dude.
You just turned 50, just, right? Like this year?
Yeah, in February. It's like, I don't feel any different, really, except for that it hurts more.
Right.
You know? Right. Like, when I turn 50, I'm like, am I supposed to feel something? I'm sat there and waited. I'm like, nah, I don't feel anything. I'm still me. So,
yeah.
You know, it's just the same shit.
Yeah, it's just the same shit. I actually feel I've been working out more, like trying to, like, you know, I got like a trainer and I started lifting weights. I was like, okay, I don't want to go to shit now. Like,
yeah. Yeah. I was doing some push-ups and some lifting a little before this tour to try to get in shape. And then my grandma got real sick. So, like, for the last 3 weeks of this, before this tour, like, I was with my grandma. She was in hospice, you know. So I was with her every day until she passed, and I wasn't working out or anything. So I came out here, and it's just like, I feel like someone hit me with a goddamn baseball bat every night, you know?
Yeah, that first week can be rough on tour anyway, no matter how fucking in shape you are.
Oh, God. Because you aren't supposed to, this is, the human body isn't meant to move the way we move. You know? Right. Have you ever had your neck x-rayed?
Oh yeah, I gotta go to the chiropractor. I've had herniated discs in my neck and lower back, and like, yeah, I'm
the curve of my neck is reversed, you know.
Yeah,
I don't, fucking head, man.
Yeah, no, right. It's supposed to go like that, and
it's supposed to go like that, and then mine's like this, dude.
Mine's fucking shot.
Yeah, shot, totally shot. You know, and my knees are screwed up, my ankles are screwed up, not just from this, but from skateboarding since I was a child. So it's just like I'm a mess. You know, but I keep going. Last night's show.
You do the chiropractor? You ever do the chiropractor or anything like that?
Yeah. Last night's show was interesting. I've been taking some Tylenol before the show, you know, like normally half an hour. I didn't realize until later. I was like, why am I so like groggy tonight? I had taken like 3 or 4 Tylenol PM before we went on stage. I'm like, fuck is going on? You know, I still did the show, still did my jumping around like a monkey bullshit. When I got on stage, I was like, done. So I slept like 12 hours last night. I feel pretty good today.
That's fucking awesome. 12 yeah. hours on tour, dude. That's like legendary shit right there. Like, pray for that. You sleep, sleep good on the road? You sleep good on the road, like on the bus?
Not this tour. it's been a bumpy ride. I don't know why, particularly sometimes, man.
Yeah.
But like, not really. I'm always tired on tour. You know?
Yeah. Like that, nobody, you know, everybody thinks it's like luxury, and it is a luxury, you know, don't get me wrong. Like the fucking bus, the bus is way better than the van. So like,
yes, 100%.
I'm not gonna sit here and say it's not a luxury compared to the van, but you know, you're, for me, I know like bumping down the road for 5 hours, it just, you know, you get into fucking Detroit. Oh my God. Like the fucking potholes are like,
Oh yeah. Well, we went from Boston to Philly basically. And that whole stretch of road is one big pothole, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. You can park. I don't really fall asleep until we park, you know, and then I
can fall asleep before we park.
Yeah, same. I can too, but I feel like I'm constantly woken up. Like I'll go to sleep real quick, and then I'll wake up, and then when we park, I'm like, oh, good, okay, we're
okay.
Then it's just motherfuckers slamming the fucking door and shaking the whole bus.
Just like 100%. 100%. That's it.
Yeah. Art Cruz doing good? That fucking goddamn card magician, Art Cruz. Is he killing it?
He's doing real good, man. He's hitting them real hard. I think we may have to get a taller drum riser. Like Megadeth has like this like 12-foot tall drum riser. I think we may have to eventually get one because he hits so hard, dude, which I love.
Yes.
But it's bleeding. His snare is bleeding into the vocal mic.
Oh, wow.
So yeah.
Fucking loud. Like,
yeah. So like we're having a few little issues there. And I'm not going to tell him to hit softer.
Right. Yeah.
You know? So we may have to jack him up a little bit.
Yeah. And you don't want to get one of those glass things.
Right? No.
The clear plastic or whatever. That's just kind of.
No, I can't. I like to be present. But if he goes even higher, then that'll be something higher for me to jump off of too. Right. So I don't know.
That'll look cool.
Yeah. Until I break my leg, you know, it's coming eventually.
Has he got any new card tricks? That motherfucker is like the card magician, of death. I love him. We did a couple of mayhem tours with him, and he was just teching for people. And I was like, this dude's the best. Like, he's fucking.
Dude, he could do the card tricks, the coin tricks. He does this one thing where he makes a coin shoot up. It's crazy, dude. But I haven't seen him. I haven't seen him doing any magic this tour. I'm going to need to get him on that, you know.
Right.
But he's a member of the Magic Castle in L.A.
Oh, okay.
Has been since he's a kid. I don't know if you've ever been there, but it's like it's a castle in Hollywood, I guess, where it's all magicians. Only magicians can be members, and like they can bring guests but you can't. There's no cell phones there, no nothing. You go in there, and it's all just like professional magicians hanging out doing like magic shit, you know. So he's going to carry me one day. I want to go really bad, you know.
Yeah, that sounds cool. Yeah. That sounds killer.
Yeah, dude. Yeah,
tell him what's up. I love that motherfucker.
I will, for sure.
You, I got to say, your band has done exceptionally well in certainly in the press with regards to getting new drummer, the whole Chris leaving the band. I mean, it's all been very, very... you know, even on his end, you know, like it's been pretty, pretty quiet on the Western front. There hasn't really been any kind of, you know, flare ups or anything. And like, you know, kudos to you guys for that, man. That's awesome.
Thank you. Why would there be? There's no reason for that nonsense. You know, this is a heavy metal band, not a goddamn boy band. You know, this is not, I'm not interested in drama, teen magazine bullshit. You know what I mean? Fuck it. Just no reason for it.
Yeah. Things are, I was reading that Willie, he was saying that he hadn't spoken to Willie in a while.
That's between them, bro. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's gotta be, you know, there's so many layers to it. And, you know, I just had some guys leave myself that were longtime members. So, you know, there's always that kind of, you know, it hurts, you know, like there's a part of you, you know, you've lived a lot of life, you know, good and bad, and it ends and then, you know, you move on.
Yeah. It's life, dude.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
Totally. You're just reminded by it when people talk to you like this, or like when you do an interview, or
even
a fan, you know, like, cause you're like, I haven't thought about that, dude. You know, it's like you get a new, you know, not that I've ever had I've only been married one time in my life, but you know, you get a new girlfriend and people are like, oh, you've got a new girlfriend. I think I like the old girlfriend better. And you're like, wait, hold on a second. Wait, what?
I really, you know, what Lamb of God does, and if there were anything like, if there were anything like tabloid worthy or anything like that, you know, we would just keep that to ourselves, because it's our music, you know, that's what we're about. Not about drama. I don't care. You know, we wish Chris the best.
Yep.
Everything is okay.
Yeah. Awesome. Awesome. Good to hear, man. And you're coming up on 14 years sobriety, 10 years sobriety,
11
years sobriety. Congratulations, yeah, man. That's huge.
Thank you, dude. I mean, it's not something kind of like with the drummer, ex-drummer situation. It's not something I think about a lot unless someone brings it up. It's just the way it is now. And I, you know, unless I'm talking to other people who are having problems, I don't really think about drinking now, except for in an abstract sense. Every now and then I might be like, I wonder what it would be like if I drank. I mean, not even like it's appealing to me, but I just kind of like in an abstract sense, I'm like if something bad happens, for instance, on tour, like some sort of disaster happens, I'd be like, if I was drinking right now, well, this would just be a whole lot worse, because I'd do something really stupid, you know? So, but other than that, I don't really think about it. I mean, I'm on heavy metal tour, dude. I'm around people drinking all fucking day long.
Right.
It does not bother me.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. In fact, it's even fun for a few hours. You know, like there's always that few hours when you're hanging around the drunk people and they're like, yeah, this is fucking great. These people, it's fun. And then it crosses that one point.
And when they cross the line, then they go from being like chatty, fun to like, okay, I'm going to go hide now.
I'm annoyed now. Yeah.
And that's all I do. I don't sit there and let myself get annoyed by drunk people.
Right.
You know? Because I was that annoying drunk person for a long time. I just split. It's easy.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, these guys are at that level. And I think I'm going to make my exit now and go sit and read my fucking, you know, science fiction novel and be a nerd in the back lounge. It's all right. You know?
Totally.
No worries. Exactly. No worries. And then
reading's the best way to get away from all of it. Just go in your bunk or the back lounge and that's awesome.
And then I wake up the next day and look at everybody all hungover and laughing in their face. Like, how you feeling? How you feeling, buddy?
I got to say, on that tour that we did with you guys, which is right at the beginning of the Black, which 14 years ago, which is fucking crazy that was 14 fucking years ago. But you were, I mean, I was surprised how hard you were going. You know, like, I don't think we ever talked about it. I never said anything. And Lord knows there's been plenty of points when I was going that hard on the road.
Right.
I never, like, with the pills, I never got crazy about the pills. It was like my tech always had Vicodin, so we'd pop Vicodins. But Vicodins were always, like, speed to me, so it always kept me awake. And then I fucking hated it. You know, so you were.
No, I did. I was a garbage can, dude. I'd eat pills, snort coke, fucking take ecstasy, drink whatever's in front of me. Only thing I never fucked with really much was weed. Yeah. I like real drugs. Yeah.
You never really smoked weed, huh?
Nah, it just makes me hungry and paranoid and sleepy.
Yeah.
You know?
So, it makes me paranoid, totally.
Yeah.
It makes me sleepy.
I wouldn't want to do anything that makes me paranoid, you know? So, I mean, all that, dude, it was just...
You rode with us on the bus one night. I don't know if you remember this, but you rode with us on
the
bus.
No, of course not.
Yeah.
Of course not.
And you went, like, you just wanted to rage. And it was like a show night. I think we were doing a video shoot the next day. And I was just like, you came on and you're like, let's fucking rage. And I was like, this is not the night that I was like, I'm fucking, you know, we're getting ready to do that. Just like, fuck. And you were just like, rock, like following me. I was like, oh my God. I was like, bro, hey, let's wait till the next day off. Like, and I'll fucking go hard with you. But like tonight, not tonight. Like I'm going to bed. Like I'm going to go read my book and fucking.
I told you.
You were extremely disappointed. You were so disappointed. I was just like, I'm sorry to disappoint you. Like,
you know, I was an aggressive encourager of fun. And
yes,
bad
you
decisions.
Were.
I would aggressively encourage other people. I aggressively encourage other people to have fun and make poor life decisions. You know?
Totally.
You know?
Actually got like sad at one point. You like came and talked to me like, man, I rode on the bus to party with you, bro. And I was just like, oh my God. And I'm like, look, bro, I love you. Like, you're awesome.
I apologize.
It ain't happening tonight.
I do not remember that at all, but I believe you 100%.
And then you woke up and fucking just like you and I woke up at about the same time and fucking you just picked up where you left off. I was like, damn, this dude's a fucking maniac. I was like, you go.
Oh yeah, dude.
You go.
At the end of my drinking, you know, I had to drink before I could eat anything that day. Like my stomach was so fucked up, I had to drink a fucking beer before I could put food in me. And that wasn't fun, you know. At the end of my drinking, all the like, let's party together, all that shit was done, dude. I drank every bit of fun out of drinking. So it's done with it. It's all good.
Yeah. I'm happy for you, man. I think that's amazing. Yeah. You know, it's a big accomplishment to go from, you know, that extreme to now
mania.
I don't want to say you're extreme in being sober, because being sober is awesome. You know, it's an extreme in rock and roll, but it's not an extreme in the real world.
Yeah. No, it's normal.
Yeah.
You know, it's like not everybody wakes up and starts drinking, you know? Like, which was incomprehensible to me for a while. Like, I didn't understand how someone could, like, a normal person could just have one beer. I still don't. Like, I've never had one beer in my fucking life. Never. You know? Like, I can't remember. Some fucking doctor asked me one time, one of the rare times I went to see a doctor back then. It's like, well, how much do you drink on a daily basis? And I just looked at him and I said, all of it. All of it, bro.
Yeah.
That's it. Whatever that may be. How much you drink? All of it. That's the way I drink. So, you know, it was a good run. Now it's done.
Yeah. You actually, I had not soon after that tour, but like, you know, probably, I guess it was like 2 or 3 years later, I had gone through my own. You know, I had always drank, you know, I drank on stage. And so like, I was pretty good. Like I would drink before the state show, drink on the show. And then I'd stop drinking after the show, which was some weird wall that I could like put up like, okay, you're done. I don't know why I can't.
Not me.
That. Yeah. And, but then I'd got to a point where I started counting like a pre gig drink. You know, like I just used to eye it, you know, like I just, here's a solo cup, here's vodka, here's Coke, like fucking, you know, I never measured how many shots anything was or, right. So my pre-gig drink was 6 shots of vodka. And that was, I'd start drinking about 45 minutes before the show. And then I'd get up on
45 minutes.
Yeah. I'd drink that in 45 minutes.
Jesus Christ, dude.
And then I'd go on stage and I'd always have like a couple of drinks on stage to like drink and throw out to the crowd. So, and I'd have a couple of those on stage. So I'd probably get another 2 shots before walking on stage. And then if it was, you know, if it was like a regular show, I'd probably have like another 3 or 4 shots and then that would be the end of it. So I'd have 11 shots of vodka and then I'd stop. But if it was a good show, I'd probably have maybe 5 or 6 shots on stage. And then if I had the day off the next day, then it was like, I'll party because I don't have to sing tomorrow. And like, I, you know, it was always about like my throat. So like, if I could, like, I don't have to sing. So then I'd do another 3 or 4 drinks, which is like another 18 shots on top of the 11 shots that I was doing. And then like 4 or 5 beers. And I measured it one day and I was just like, holy shit, like this is like more, you know, more than I ever could have fucking imagined. And I was like,
yeah,
and I went through a rough patch and I was like, okay, I gotta quit drinking. And I reached out to you. I'm not even sure why I reached out to you either, because you had just gotten sober, and I, you know, I don't,
right.
you know, I didn't feel like you were some like sober coach at that point, but I did. And
right.
And you actually sent me a really, really long text with all this. I don't know if you had pasted it or if you wrote it yourself, but it had like a bunch of steps and it had a bunch of like, you know, and one of the things you said was, if you can't get sober, if you can't be sober for a year, you know, these are the signs you're an alcoholic, you know, blah, 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 blah. And, and one of them was that stuck with me. If you can't get sober for a year and not have a drop of alcohol, you're an alcoholic.
For more than likely, yes. Like normal people, that's the whole thing I was saying. It's like I did not comprehend like normal people. Normal people can not drink and it's okay. Like it's okay to not drink for normal people. Like, oh, I would like to have a beer now, supposedly. You know, if they're somewhere where it's like, oh, do you have any beer? No. They're not going to go into a rage. You know what I mean? It's like, okay, well, then I'll have a soda. You know, a beer would be nice, but fuck it. You know, like if a normal person, like there's this guy, I do the cameo thing now, which has been really interesting because I've gotten a lot of very interesting cameos, not just like happy birthday. I've gotten some from like people who are fighting cancer. A lot of people who are getting, really, really heavy stuff. A lot of people who are, you know, struggling with alcoholism or have been sober X amount of years and they want a happy sobriety anniversary, you know.
That's cool.
I do a lot of that, but this one guy sent me one. He's like, my name is, I can't remember his name, but it like was bizarre to me. It's like, I think his wife sent it to me. Let's call him Jeff. That's not his real name, I don't think. This is a cameo from my husband, Jeff, who has not drank for 1 year now. And it's a congratulations on that. But make it really lighthearted because he quit drinking just for fun. And I was like, what?
Just for fun?
Just for fun.
Wow.
And I'm like, who quits drinking just for fun? Right? Like, who wakes up and is like, just for shits and giggles, I'm going to quit drinking today. You know what I mean? Everybody I know that has quit drinking because, you know, their wife left them. They became homeless. Their band broke up. You know, they were, in my case, just miserable.
Hit the bottom. Yeah, hit the bottom.
But nobody, I'd never heard of one person.
I've literally never heard of that either.
I've never heard of one person say, I know. I think it'll be fun. I'll just quit drinking for a year. It's like, what? What? That makes no sense. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because like for me, like I was going to drink until it was not fun anymore. You know, so it's very interesting. But yeah, dude, like my brother, when I was still struggling to quit drinking, it's another thing I don't understand normal people. My brother and his wife were coming up from North Carolina to visit me, my kid brother, right? And my brother likes Newcastle Brown Ale, right? So he was driving up, and I wasn't drinking at that time. I hadn't fully gotten it yet. I struggled for like 4 years trying to quit drinking before I finally got it. But he was coming up to stay with me, him and his wife, and I said, okay, Scott.
Wait, you were still drinking, but you were struggling to not drink at this
point. I had periods where I would not drink for a period of 1 to 3 months.
Okay.
And that went on for 4 years, dude.
Okay.
And then I'd like, I wouldn't drink, and then all of a sudden I'd be like, fuck it, I'm gonna get drunk. That went on for like 4 fucking years.
And then you'd drink for 4 months.
Yeah, exactly. Normally as soon as I got on tour, you know.
Right. So you'd kind of pull it together for like the wife or pull it together for family.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So like my brother was coming to visit me during this time. And I was like, it's like a 5-hour drive. And I'm like, so you want me to buy some beer for you, you know? So when you get here, you have a beer after the drive. I know what you like. He's like, yeah. I'm like, how much do you want me to get? He was going to be there for the weekend. You want a case, two cases? He's like, a six pack. And I'm like, a six pack for you and the wife for the whole weekend. He's like, yeah, that'll be fine. And I'm like, I have money, dude. I'll buy you like cases, right? And it's my alcoholism coming out, like getting kind of irritated with him. He's like, no, Randy, a six pack is fine. So I'm like, all right, well, you know, and I go and buy him a six pack and I think, you know, he'll go through this and I'll go back to the store and get him some more. That motherfucker came there. He drank one beer and then him and his wife split a beer. So over the weekend, it was 1.5 beers and there was half a beer still left in the refrigerator. And when he was leaving, I grabbed it. It was 4.5 beers left, right? And I took it out to him. I'm like, get this shit out of my house. You don't know how to fucking drink. You haven't learned anything from me. I was pissed, dude. Like,
what'd you say? You haven't learned anything from me?
You haven't learned a thing from me, right? It's my kid brother. And I did not understand.
I taught you how to drink terribly.
Yeah, I did not understand that was normal. That's what normal people don't have to drink at all. Like, it did not. Yeah, I did not understand it, you know. I understand it now.
Yeah.
You know. And my mom for a while she was very glad I quit drinking because I worried my family to death. But for a while, in the beginning, she still didn't understand. I just don't understand why you can't just have like one beer. And I'm like, Mom, because I'm an alcoholic. That's why. You know? And nobody in my family, I don't come from a family of alcoholics or anything. Nobody in my family has that issue but me, you know? So they're just kind of like, they're what I call earth people, you know, normal people. I'm from outer space. Like, it took me a long time to really comprehend. And particularly, dude, living in the environment that you and I do, that what we do, that kind of drinking is not normal.
Yeah.
You know, it's not. It's not normal. And I have nothing against people who drink normally, you know? Like, I'm not this like, you can't fucking drink, you know? I think it's good for normal people to even get really shithoused every now and then because they wake up with a hangover and they're like, oh, I'm not going to do that again. It reminds them.
Yep.
You know? With me, I wake up with a hangover and I'm like, oh, I need a beer, you know? Normal people, they don't do that shit, you know? So I didn't comprehend that how abnormal I was. You know?
I think it's often, you know, it's kind of expected when you're in a band, you know, like
100%.
You're expected to be, certainly when you're the front man, singer, like you're
in a heavy crazy metal band.
Drunk in a heavy, you're supposed to be drunk and wild and drugs and, you know, you've got, I mean, I started doing speed when I was 17 and, right. You know, Bay Area thrash scene, like everybody was on speed and it just, and in my mind, I remember thinking like, oh, you got to do speed to like play speed metal, you know, like that.
Right.
So, you know, Lemmy, Motorhead, like, you know, all of
that. Yeah.
Like there was a. And, you know, even if it was not necessarily true, there was this kind of expectation that you would do drugs and you would drink and get shit faced and then go play thrash metal. And that just, you know, was very easily accessible. It was kind of everywhere. If you wanted it, there it was. And it becomes very normalized, you know, like, you know, like when I started Machine Head, heroin was like the rage in the Bay Area. And it became totally normalized to fucking just, okay, I'm going to go out and do heroin. Like
Black
and then go to a show. I'm going to go snort some heroin and then go see Fear over at the I-Beam. But then I got to throw up every fucking 10 minutes start driving over the fucking Bay Bridge. And I missed the fucking show. I was so pissed. It was like, they just gotten back together. And I fucking, one of my favorite bands, you know, Fear the Record is like, you know, all time favorite.
Yeah, I love it.
And I'm like, I'm sitting there thinking like, I just missed one of my favorite bands of all time to fucking get high. Like, and I fucking threw up all the way here And that's why we're late, because we had to pull over and I had to throw up out of the fucking car. Like, this is fucking, did I stop? No.
No. you had a moment of clarity, at least.
I did, yeah, some, you know, but, you know, you and I, you know, I think when you and I are in this, it's like, it's so fucking easy. And, you know, I commend you for 11 years, you know, continuing to be on the road. You know, some people have to, like, leave being in a band and leave being touring. You know, you've
managed. I'm not at 11 years yet. I'm at 10 years. I got sober on tour.
Yeah. That's awesome.
You know,
that's amazing.
You know, we were on tour with Metallica, and, you know, Hetfield helped me a lot, and some of his crew were sober. So
yeah. Didn't you pass out at an airport or something in Australia?
Oh yeah. That was
they left
before
you.
That. Okay. That was before that. That was a different tour in Texas. You know? Yeah. I passed out in front of an airport. Pretty ridiculous shit, you know. Luckily, someone we knew came and got me. Otherwise, I'd be in deep shit, because that's, you can't be all fucked up on airport property. It's federal charges.
Oof.
You know?
Yeah.
So, whoops. Oops. Sorry. No, I got sober on tour, and I kind of think I needed to get sober on tour in order to, for me, I'm just saying for me, not for anyone else, but I got sober on tour. I think I needed to, because I would always say to myself, I'm partying on tour, it's like, well, I'll get home and I'll get, you know, I'll clean up eventually. You know, when we get home, I'll do this.
Would you do that for your wife? Like, would your wife get pissed that you were drunk? And so there was that. There's a line that you're drawing there somewhere. What's the line?
Yeah. Well, look, dude, I'm at home, you know, and as you're saying, heavy metal tour, it's expected. So, you know, this is like, tour is not the real world. It's fantasy land, you know, so you can get away with shit in fantasy land, you know. At home, it's just like, yeah, I mean, for sure, my wife didn't want to see me drunk, you know, so there's that. And also just like, you can't behave at home like you can on tour. On tour, everyone's happy to see you. You're like in this bubble, right? You're backstage. People are making you food. Like, you have a dressing room. All you have to do is get on stage and see yourself. At home, you have to do things like drive a car, you know, go to City Hall to fucking pay the power bill that's late or whatever. Right? You can't show up completely fucked out of your mind on Jägermeister and cocaine to be like, yeah, I'm here to fucking pay the power bill, you know? That just doesn't work, you know? So I was trying to, like, dial it back so that
did you ever show up to City Hall on Jägermeister and cocaine to pay the power bill like that? Even once?
I definitely showed up for jury duty. This is before the band even.
Okay.
I was cooking at a place called Third Street Diner, and John used to work there too. We didn't work there at the same time, but I was cooking there, and I was working the 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. shift. And I'd get off at 7 a.m. and then, you know, because you're on a vampire shift, you start drinking when you get off work. So it's 7:30 in the morning. You're doing shots of Jaeger at the bar, the 24-hour diner. And I got called for jury duty. And I was like, motherfucker. You know, I had to be in there at jury duty for jury duty selection at 8:30. So I just walked in from jury duty. I got off at 7 a.m., started drinking, somehow staggered like a few blocks over to the court building where it was, to walk into jury duty drunk as shit, wearing my fucking punk rock leather jacket and spikes and my dirty ass like line cook clothes, just covered in grease, smelling like a brewery. And I showed up. They're like, signed in, and they looked at me and they're like, Mr. Bly. I'm like, yeah. They're like, you can go home for the day. And I'm like, thanks, dude. So that was like near City Hall, you
kind
know.
Kind of mission accomplished though, right? Like,
yeah, exactly.
I don't want to go to fucking jury duty.
I don't want to do the jury duty. I mean, they could have arrested me for drunk in public easily.
Right.
You know?
Right.
But somehow I got away with it.
How old are you at this point?
probably 21, 22 years old.
So, yeah, so you're past your teens.
Yeah.
Take me back to young Randy or David or whatever you were back then. Were you David back then?
That's Randy. Randy, always Randy, my whole life. You know, to what? How old?
Like being a kid. Like, did you grew up like in Virginia? Like,
I was born in Maryland.
Okay.
And lived there for like 1 year, 1.5 years. I don't remember it really. You know, I was born on an Army base, Fort Meade, Maryland.
Okay. Because
my dad was in the Air Force, and he was working for the NSA at that time in 71 during the Cold War, doing something with like code breaking, like the Russians, because my dad's real smart, you know. But I was born and lived in a tiny little base housing, like a little apartment on base. And then
what'd your mom do?
Grew up. She's a housewife.
Okay.
You know,
living there on the base with dad.
Yeah. Yeah. Ooh. And I'm the oldest of the four boys. So, and then, you know, from there lived in North Carolina for a while. And then my parents split up when I was in the third grade. So me and my brothers went with my dad. My mom went to college to get a degree, you know, because my dad was already educated, so he could support us. And my mom went to college in North Carolina to UNC. And me and my brothers moved with my dad to Virginia and lived with my grandma for a while on her farm.
Oh, okay.
Out in the country. And I just basically...
Where's your dad at this point?
He's with us
with the grandma. Okay, at the grandma.
Yeah.
Whole family went.
Yeah, except for my mom, because she was getting a degree in order to make a living. Because, you know, all you have is a high school degree, and it was hard to make a living. I grew up basically in the splitting time in between my dad and my mom's. My mom was in the Cape Fear region of North Carolina, Wilmington, Wrightsville Beach.
Okay.
And then my dad was in the Tidewater area of Virginia, which is Southeast Virginia, like Norfolk, Virginia Beach, Chesapeake, all that area. So grew up in those areas. And then in 89, went to college in Richmond. I went to Richmond to go to college. Right. But I really went there because there were better punk rock shows, you know?
I did
miserably in college.
Was anybody in your family musical? Like your mom or your dad?
My mom has a beautiful singing voice, and my dad can play the banjo.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Neither of which I have.
Yeah. But like you're not exposed to music, right? Like your family isn't, you know, jamming or what? Are they playing records? Like, are they playing records?
A lot of like my mom would play records. Yeah. Like I remember, you know, she had vinyl. She had like Rapper's Delight.
Oh,
first
yeah.
Real, but yeah,
the oh, Sugar Hill Gang. Yeah.
Yeah. She had that vinyl and I really loved that. She also had
Chicken Tastes Like Wood.
Yeah, exactly. She had an REO Speedwagon record.
Nice.
But she got really into Jimmy Buffett for a while, and I still pick on her to this day about Jimmy Buffett, you know. She loved Jimmy Buffett for a while. But now she's totally in love with Bon Jovi. So when we're on tour and like if we play a venue where Bon Jovi is played and there's, you know, a picture of him backstage or something, I always take a picture of it and send it to him. Like, I'm in Bon Jovi's dressing room, you know?
That's right. she was crazy about, like, the Margaritaville?
Oh, yeah, all that stuff, you know? Yeah. She's beach person, you know?
Right. Yeah, that's, like, perfect beach music right there.
Yeah, yeah, yes, it is.
So you start surfing. Do you start surfing at this time?
No, I couldn't afford surfing. Okay. Like, my family didn't have money. Surfboards are expensive. I started skateboarding when I was really young.
Yeah.
You know, I had like the banana board in the 70s.
Yes. You know? Yes. Love the banana board.
That shit. And then, you know, in like fifth or sixth grade, I got a Vision Gator and really started skating for real. You know, And that was all I wanted to do, is skateboard and listen to punk rock music through high school.
So you're listening to like punk rock in sixth grade?
Mm-hmm. I got turned on to the Sex Pistols in like sixth grade. That was it.
Yeah, that's a cool friend right there. Whoever turned it, you know.
Jason Smith from Virginia Beach, Virginia, gave me a cassette, dubbed cassette tape with Nevermind the Bollocks on one side and Bob Marley on the other.
Oh, wow.
So, mm-hmm. Yeah. So
that's a good introduction right there.
Yeah. Not Bob Marley legend.
Did you like Bob Marley at that point?
Yeah.
Did you?
I love reggae. I'm a huge reggae fan.
Yeah. I mean, in sixth grade, though, like, you know, like that would have been like, whoa, what is this?
Yeah. It was different. I didn't like the music on the radio. You know, I didn't like it. Like, it was all I had. I definitely was attracted to anything more edgy, you know, or whatever. But I lived in little redneck town, dude. There's no record store. No, like, I'm not from the Bay Area where, like, there was a scene or anything, you know, from the country.
Yeah.
So I got turned on to this by this kid, Jason, who gave me this mixtape. And then from there, I just started learning about punk rock slowly but surely, because there was no internet then.
Yeah.
You know,
for sure.
And then my younger brother, like, we had Black Sabbath. We had like a Black Sabbath cassette tape when we were younger, and I liked that. But as far as metal, like any like stuff, you know, like Metallica or you know, you guys or whatever, Pantera, anything, my younger brother got into that stuff before I did.
Oh, okay.
He would be like, check out this band Obituary, check out this band Bolt Thrower, because I was listening to just punk rock and hardcore. So really, I didn't really start getting into metal until like, I don't know, after high school.
Oh, wow. Okay. So all through high school, you're listening to like, what are you listening to? Like, what's hardcore?
Misfits, okay. Misfits, Bad Brains, Black Flag, Sex Pistols, Samhain, MDC, Septic Death, COC, The Accused.
Yeah. Like the early COC, Technocracy era.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Before that.
I mean, that would have been like, the fucking killer shit though. Like, especially from they're like a band from your area.
Yeah. Yeah. And I was in North Carolina a lot. So I was being turned on. I learned a lot about this music from skateboarding because, you know, now skateboarding, a lot of it is connected with hip hop, you know, but in the 80s, it was all punk rock, skate rock. There's a whole genre of skate rock, you know? So, Thrasher put out these compilations called Skate Rock and Volume 3, Skate Rock, Volume 3, Wild Riders of Boards. I learned about COC from that. I learned about The Accused from that. I learned about Septic Death from that. I learned about Gangrene from that tape.
Right.
You know, it just, there was a lot of worlds that opened up. And I used to read Thrasher, and there was a lot of like music coverage in that.
Totally. You know? Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. I was, you know, you always wonder where people are getting their stuff from. You know, like I got to say, like the same thing with me. I was a metalhead, but I skated and I hung out. The only people, I was living in Fremont, like a suburb, you know, about 50 miles south of the Bay Area. And, you know, it might as well have been fucking Nevada, you know, or fucking Utah. Like it was, there was no way to get to the Bay Area. So we were just isolated, but we had those same things. And all the punk, you know, I got turned on all these punk rock bands. Because I'm just skating with these punk rock kids because they're the only people who skateboard like in my area.
Yeah. Yeah. That's it. That was the skateboarding. You know, I got into skateboarding before I got into punk rock, you know, and skateboarding gave me punk rock. Like even the guy, Jason, who gave me that Sex Pistols tape, because at that time, the sort of most edgy music I had heard was Motley Crue, Shout at the Devil. And you know, and I know Nicky, you know, he's my buddy. I talked to him about this and I'm like, you know, I like that song. And I always felt there was something more going on with that song than just Satan. And he talked, you know, it's about politics, that song is. So it's, he has a little bit of a punk rock background too, but I was like, kind of listening to that because it was the most aggressive thing I could find.
That record's great. And, I love Shout at the Devil.
And my buddy, this guy Jason, I met at summer camp for gifted and talented kids at UVA. I went to college for a couple of summers, in like sixth and seventh grade.
You went
at
to
UVA.
He, college in sixth and seventh grade? Okay.
Yeah, a summer camp.
Oh, okay.
You could get college credits.
Oh, wow.
So I went and took a sociology course over the summer with a bunch of other gifted and talented kids. But this kid there from Virginia Beach, Jason, was just like, if you like that stuff, you need to check this out. And he gave me the Sex Pistols in like sixth grade. And that changed everything.
Yeah.
Everything changed immediately. I heard it and I was like, these guys are pissed. I don't exactly understand what it is that's going on with this music. Like, and there was a lot of like British references,
right?
You know, specific in their lyrics to like the Margaret Thatcher era of England.
For sure. Absolutely.
I was like, but they're pissed and it's real.
Yeah.
This is something very real. And I identified with it immediately from the first song, Holidays song. It comes in and they're just pissed. I'm like, oh, this is it, you know. And I tried to learn about that shit from there. And then for a while, I thought only real punk rock came from England, right? So I was like this shitty, like, I, you know how kids are shitty. They think they know things. Someone was trying to turn me on to like American hardcore and shit. Like, that's not real. That's not punk rock. That's not from England. So I, like an asshole, right? But through the skateboarders, I started learning about, you know, Black Flag and Bad Brains and Minor Threat and COC and all that. The skateboarding gave me American punk rock, you know. And the kid who gave me the Sex Pistols tape was a skateboarder too. So skateboarding gave me punk rock in the first place.
I still think that the maybe my favorite song off of Nevermind the Bollocks is Bodies.
Oh, it's great.
Bodies is just... fuck, I fucking love that. I don't know, man, I think that might have even been the first song that I loved off of that record.
Right.
So
it's so good. It's such a perfect record, you know.
It is. When you're not in a band at any point during this time? Like, you're not?
I had a high school band with my buddy Alex, who I'm still friends with, and we never got out of the garage. And we were called Black Monday or Black Friday. I can't remember which. It's a nickname for a famous stock market crash that kicked off the depression. Okay. Right. And Alex played guitar and I can't remember who fucked around on drums. And I sang, and we didn't have a PA, so he hooked up like stereo speakers that hung from the ceiling and somehow wired a shitty mic to it. And he says he's got these tapes somewhere of us practicing. We never made it out of the garage, but I was singing. Awesome. It was kind of like blues, punk rock type stuff. And I remember just singing about all sorts of shit that I knew nothing about involving drinking. It was kind of prophetic because I didn't really drink at that time.
Okay.
But it was like these like songs about riding down the road, drinking vodka. Right. And I'm in like the 12th grade or whatever, you know, but we never made it out of the garage. You know, he says he's got practice tape somewhere. So I want to hear him.
That's interesting to me that you weren't drinking in the 12th grade.
I was drinking a little bit.
Okay.
On the weekends. And my girlfriend.
Oh, yeah.
My first real. In the 12th grade, I got a girlfriend, hot girl, dude. It was unbelievable. Like, I was never had a girlfriend until like 12th grade. And then I got this hot girlfriend.
What's your pickup line for your hot girlfriend?
There was no pickup line. We just started talking and we started talking about music.
Okay.
You know, because I went to a school for the arts my last 2 years of high school.
Oh, okay. Rad.
Otherwise, I never would have graduated. Because I couldn't deal with regular high school. I was just like, fuck this. I'm going to quit. And then these people sent me to a school for the arts. And there were a bunch of other freaks there, you know.
Oh, cool.
And that's where I met my girlfriend. But I started dating her my senior year. And I was drinking a little bit on the weekends. But when we would drink, she would drink a lot. And more than me, and want to drive, and I'd have to take her keys and all that stuff. And I remember being worried about her and saying, you know, you need to watch your drinking or you're going to turn into an alcoholic, you know. And then as far as I know, she's happy and normal and like has, you know, has the kids and a nice career and stuff. And here I am, the total alcoholic, you know, who has to not drink.
Well, that's interesting. That's so interesting, you know, but you know, like I think at that age, like you have no idea, like no one knows where their life's going to go at that point.
No clueless.
You're 17, 18, probably something like that, right?
Yeah. 18. I was 18 when I graduated high school. So
is this your 18. First relations? First time you have relations with a woman?
No.
You guys don't have relations. Oh, you had already.
Well, we do have relations.
Yeah.
I had relations before, but it wasn't a girlfriend situation. It just
right.
This older girl took care of me.
The older girl. It's funny, like sometimes those older girls want like the young guy, the 15, 16-year-old dude. I known a bunch of like my friends, the first time they got laid was by like a 25-year-old chick.
She was older than me. I think I was 12.
12? Holy shit. Dude, that's really young. Holy fuck.
Yeah, too young.
Yeah.
Too young. But I remember being in high school.
You started jerking off at that point? I mean, I guess so. Jesus.
Yeah. I was 12.
How old was she?
God bless this girl. 18.
Yeah. right.
But it happened once, you know? And then didn't happen again for many years. But I remember being in high school and hearing all these dudes like growing up talking about, oh, I get this girl, get that. And I'm like, you motherfuckers don't have a clue. You know? And I was just quiet. I just sat back and was quiet about it, you know?
Right.
So it was too young. It was too young, but whatever. You know, I don't think kids shouldn't be banging at 12 years old.
that's wildly. I was just talking to a buddy of mine just last week, and he got laid at 13 for the first time. I was like, 13? I was like, holy shit, man.
I may have been 13. It was either 12 or 13.
Okay. Yeah. I was going to ask you, like, I asked Nurgle, like, hey, so how long did you last on your first time? But I'm not going to ask you, like, if you're 12, like, the fact that you even did it is crazy.
probably, 30 seconds. I'm amazed it happened at all. You know?
Right. Totally. You've got to be just like, this is fucking awesome.
I Casanova, I was hot. You know what I mean?
Well, you must have had some game.
I don't know, man. It wasn't like all of a sudden I started macking after that. It was just a one-time thing, you know? And then a long drought.
Yeah. I mean, it was probably more the girl. You know, like,
oh yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which I think a lot of times, I think for musicians, at least the people I've talked to, and I know in my own experience, like so many times in my life, like I've got no game, like fucking, if I got because girls like came to me and like just fell in my lap. I'm like, sweet. Like this is awesome.
No, dude, girls, you know, I've dated before, basically like it had to be like, hey dummy, I like you. Are you going to ask me out? Like, I'm like, I'm always like, really? You like me? You know, like I'm clueless, dude. Totally clueless. No game.
So when are you finally on stage for the first time? How old are you?
Fuck, dude.
Is it when you're maybe in college?
Yeah, after college. 20 or maybe during college. Maybe 25.
Wow. Okay.
You know.
You're in bands though in this whole time?
I had a band with this guy Abe, and we were playing shows and stuff, and everybody was talented except for me. But we all wanted to be in a different band. Like the drummer wanted to be in the Smashing Pumpkins. Our bass player was classically trained bassist, so he wanted to be Charles Mingus. Our guitar player wanted to be Jimi Hendrix or in Sepultura. And I wanted to be in the Sex Pistols or the Bad Brains. So it's just a train wreck of a band. And that band broke up. And then our guitar player, Abe.
Never played shows though?
We played shows.
Oh, okay.
We played shows.
Gotcha.
We even went out of state one time and played Shippensburg, Pennsylvania.
Oh, shit.
Shippensburg. It was a big deal.
Do that. I mean, all those early first time, you know, you just get up on stage and, you know, you don't know what the fuck to do. You suck. But it's,
and you're drunk.
Fun, and it's fucking adrenaline, and you're like,
yeah. Yeah. That's how you learn. That's the requirement for becoming a good front man. It's the willingness to get up on stage in front of people, make an idiot of yourself and suck repeatedly until you get good, until finally you get good at it. That's all it takes to be a good front man. Yeah. It's just the willingness to embarrass yourself over and over and over and over again. And I possess that willingness.
Sometimes it doesn't even end.
You're right. Sometimes I still do it.
You can be 54 and still doing that.
It's still doing it. And it happens from time to time. It's all right, you know?
So do you have a fond memory of your first show, though? Like, is it just like, does the light bulb go off? Is this just like, oh my God, this is what I want to do? No, it's not like that.
Not like that. I was drunk most of the time anyway, so it's all kind of hazy.
Yeah. You're starting to drink pretty heavy at this point? Or just, you know, the usual 20-year-old drinking?
At some point in my 20s, it switched from being probably like mid-20s. I think about this. It's hard to fucking remember. At some point, it just switched. You know, it switched from partying on the weekends, you know, because I had fun, you know, like a normal person for a while. It switched sometime in my 20s. I'm not exactly sure when. It switched from like, oh, we're going to have fun and do this, to drinking is what I did. Yeah, I don't know exactly when, but it did.
Nothing to do with the band, though. Just kind of.
No, I will. No, yeah, just living life. I'd be an alcoholic. I will say that when we signed to a major in 2003, and we could all quit our day jobs, because we were a band for like 9-10 years before we were able to quit our day jobs. We did the band and worked.
Yeah.
When we signed to a major and quit our day jobs, I will say my drinking took off then, because for the first time in my life, I had money in my bank account. I actually had a bank account. Before that, I didn't have a bank account. If I got paid by check, I went to the check cashing place.
Right.
Cash only, motherfucker.
Right.
You know?
Right.
But I got like a
probably didn't even have a credit card.
No, of course not.
Right. I don't think I got a credit card until I was like 29 or something.
Yeah, no. Yeah, of course not. Why would you?
Yeah.
And like when we got an advance from the major and we were able to actually pay our bills from music, if I wasn't on tour in the studio, I don't have any responsibilities. You know, I don't have to show up to sing a song. I'm at home. I wake up in the morning, drink a pot and a half of coffee, and I'm like, all right, what do I do now? I don't have to go to work. Oh, well, fuck it. I got some money. I'll get some beer and start drinking. So it definitely, as soon as we signed to a major, like.
So you're saying all through As the Palaces Burn, you know, and the record.
The Burn the Priest record, the first album.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
New American Gospel.
Yep.
As the Palaces Burn, our first three albums.
You're working.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
All of us.
Yeah.
Every last one of us. Yeah. We're going on tour sometimes, signing autographs and shit. But we come home and work roofing or cooking or dishwashing, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's the life of a band member. You know, like people think that you're just like you get signed and you're rich. Like you're not rich.
No.
Yeah. And you might not even, you probably won't talk about it. Like if you went back to those interviews back then, like you never go, oh yeah, I'm going to go home and, you know, go be a roofer for in between this tour. It's like,
I don't know.
Yeah.
Maybe not. I don't remember. You know?
Yeah. No, that's, I love hearing stuff like that. You know, I mean, I think it's important for people to hear that side of the music business, that, you know, you're in a band for 10 years, you've got three albums under your belt, and yeah, you're still working.
Yeah. There's actually, it's funny, man. There's an Instagram account that someone sent me. I guess someone knew I was a roofer because I've talked about it before. There's an Instagram account that's like a humor account of like about trades, you know, like roofing, plumbing, bricklaying, all that shit. And there were some posts about roofers, and it showed these pictures of like these guys covered in tattoos looking ancient as fuck, like saying like the roofing crew just showed up or whatever, you know. And I'm like laughing at it. I'm like, hey, as a roofer, I resemble that comment. And then someone commented underneath it, they're like, how, you know, like, you, what was the singer of Lamb of God doing being a roofer? And I'm like, I wrote it back. I'm like, we did not hatch out of a rock star egg. You know what I'm saying? It's right. It's not how it happens, bro. Yeah. You know,
so much work leading up to that. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, so we all worked regular jobs.
Yeah. So 2000. So after As the Palaces Burn is what? 2005 is the record. That's
the record dropped. We signed in the end of 2003, I think, and Ashes of the Wake, which is the first major label record, came out in 2004, I think. 2004,
okay, gotcha.
I think so. And that was, we did Ozfest 2004 that year as well, you know.
Yeah, I met you for the first time on the Palaces tour. It was you guys, Chimera, 18 Visions and Atreyu at the Pound.
At the Pound?
At the Pound.
At the Pound, dude.
Pound,
yeah.
San Francisco. Tiny, you know, 450 cap room. It was a fucking, it was the wildest show I've ever seen. Like, sold out as fuck for Atreyu. People losing their minds. And then the whole crowd walked out. And no one was there for 18 Visions. And then a whole new crowd came in for fucking Chimera. And then a different crowd came in for you guys. I was like, this is just nuts.
Yeah, we used to have a good time playing that venue.
Yeah.
And that was before Uber, though, I remember, because I was always kind of bummed. Because I was like, we're so close to the city. I want to go into the city and go to the bookstore or whatever. Yeah. You know, go do some nerd stuff, but instead we're on like a dock,
fucking a dock, in the middle of a dock in Hunter's Point. Like, yeah. you don't want to walk around that neighborhood. Like, it's fucked up, gnarly.
Yeah, no, it was. We had really good shows at the Pound. We played there definitely more than once.
Yeah,
you know.
No, we ended up hanging though. We had we drank and fucking chilled it. We were kicking it on the Chimera bus, and I think you came over and you were like, rah, fucking, we raged.
Yeah.
It was a fun night. Man. It was a fun night.
Yeah.
You know, that was it's crazy to think that was 2003, so 18 years ago.
Yeah, I'm not here on a math scholarship, bro.
Yeah. What were you taking in college? I mean, you finished college?
English.
You went through
Okay. No, I was taking English, and I took all the classes that I wanted to take, and then at the end. Speaking of math, they're like, you have to take some math classes. And I was like, you know what? I don't feel like doing this. So I just started, like, I wasn't paying attention in college anyway, except for in the classes I liked.
Yeah.
You know?
You liked English?
I liked, literature a lot, you know? I mean, I read, I'm a writer, so, like, I like reading a lot, so I like that. And I liked, I took some anthropology classes.
Oh, right.
History classes. I enjoy stuff like that, you know.
Yeah.
But like anything technical, like math, no. And they wanted me to have a foreign language requirement. So I took German for one semester. But the teacher was this German woman who I guess I was like 20 then or something. And in retrospect, I think she was probably pretty hot, but she terrified me. She was like the German teacher, and she was like hitting on me like a lot with it. And I had a girlfriend, but it made me extremely uncomfortable. She was like probably in her mid 30s, maybe 40 or something. She was pretty fucking hot in retrospect. But I was terrified. I was like this 20-year-old kid.
And you're probably just hitting. So in awe. Like, this is my authority figure teacher.
Yes. But she was very German, so I didn't know how to process it. And she was always like, she'd invite me to her house and stuff. And like,
oh, wow.
It was very obvious what was going on. So I just stopped going to class. I was just like, whatever. And then she was still trying to contact me and stuff.
Oh,
and
shit.
And I went to like the maybe one quarter of that semester. And I just stopped going because I was terrified of this German professor. And then I looked at my grades and I still passed with a C. she still passed me with a C. So, you know, even though I didn't do anything,
right?
That's very interesting.
That is great. You could have had a little, could have had your own German language tutor there.
Yes. Well, I only know one German sentence.
Did you tell your girlfriend, like, hey, my German teacher's hitting on me?
Yeah, I think so. But I have one German sentence that I can say that I remember from German class. It stuck, and I say it every time we're in Germany. And it's, der Sonne scheint und der Himmel ist blau, which means the sun is shining and the sky is blue. So even if it's raining, I'll walk around saying my one German sentence.
The one thing that stuck with you all those years.
Yes, that's right. My dad knows one Russian sentence, and it's, I am going to the post office to mail a letter. And he'll just say that every now and then. He's been saying it my whole life. It's like, yes, Dad, I know you're going to the post office to mail a letter. He'll say it in Russian. I don't know why he knows that in Russian.
Did your family, did your parents, did they have a pretty civil divorce? Like, was there?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. So you were
100%. And they are very, very, they're the best of friends now, you know? Wow. And they'll spend time to, like, with my dad, we married, my mom didn't, but like, she's invited always to like family functions, you know? Fuck,
that's killer.
It's cool as shit. And they were very adult about splitting up. Like, they did not weaponize the children, and you see that in divorces and stuff. You see it fucks people up. My parents, like, were super, super civil. We had no idea there was any like difficulty in their marriage at all. They kept that away from the children, and I really admire that about them.
That's
and I'm happy they got divorced, because they, you know, they were not meant to be together. You know, I mean, I'm glad they were together for the time that they were, because it got me and my brothers, but like, they just weren't meant to be together romantically. And like, you know, and that's okay. I understand that as an adult now, you know, but they were really, really awesome the way they handled everything. So, you know, always grateful to them for that. Cause I see some divorces, they're super messy, and right. You know, they drag the kids into it, and it's just, it's no good. They were super adult about it.
Yeah. That's really awesome to hear. You know, I'm thinking of my, you know, I'm listening to you going, man, I wish my parents would have done that. You know, like
it was
the whole weaponized thing was like, yeah, you don't know. You don't understand that when you're young, you understand it when you're older, you know, but yeah, that's looking awesome to hear. That's cool that they're still friends.
Yeah. It's awesome, dude. You know,
like, did they remarry?
My dad did. My mom did.
Yep.
You know, I love my stepmom. She's second mom to me. Cheryl, love her to death. You know, and she gets along with my mom fine. Everything's cool. You know?
That's good. That's fucking great to hear, man. That's just like a happy ending right there. You know, like,
yeah. Yeah.
That's really cool.
Good times.
That's really cool. I'm not really
good times. Right. Divorce is never a good time, but like, good times. But like they handled it really well.
Yeah. So, I mean, it sounds like your grandma played a pretty big, you know, in some way she probably became your mom for a while, at least.
For a while, she like was taking care of me and my brothers, because my dad was working like two different jobs. Sometimes two or three jobs at the same time to feed us. And my grandma, she was working too, but like, you know, we lived with her out in country on her farm for a few years. And it was a good way to grow up, like having woods and stuff, you know. I hated it at the time. I wanted to run away to the city, you know. And now as an older person, I'm just like super grateful for having had that upbringing. And I'm oftentimes like, I want to get the fuck out of the city, you know?
Right.
But yeah, we drove her crazy. We drove my grandma crazy. Yeah.
Four boys, right?
Yeah. Three.
Okay. Three.
At the time, I have a half brother, my dad, through my mom, but I, he's just my brother, we call him. But yeah, there were three of us boys at the time, and like just little savages. And she was already in her 60s and just like driving her out of her mind, you know? But she was very stern and like, you know, she's an awesome woman. She grew up during the Depression, and had, you know, had a rough life. So she didn't put up with complaining and shit. You know, she used to say, "You don't know what hard times are."
Right.
You know, and she was right.
In some ways, I feel like I know her just from reading some of your posts about her. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Kind of hearing those things. And
you know,
that era
awesome.
Of people, man, that era of people, man, they, it's a different life that they lived.
Yeah. She was hard as a rock, dude. She lived in two houses her whole life. The one she was born in, which my cousins still have. And then the one she moved into when she married my grandfather, you know, and she lived in that house until she was 96 maybe. And then finally she went into an assisted living facility and she didn't want to leave her area. So like, she could have moved in with my parents, but like, she's like, "No, I'll stay here because some of her friends were there." And she lived there until she was 100 and a half. And she died just before this tour. But like, you know, I go visit her all the time and talk to her about, you know, when she was little, they didn't have electricity.
Right.
They didn't have
100 years ago, dude. That's crazy.
She didn't have electricity in the house she lived in until she was 19 years old. No electricity.
Wow.
And then when she was,
can you imagine?
Yeah. When she was, she told me like I interviewed her when she was 93 over the course of two different days. I have like 6 hours of interview with her, you know, of her stories. She told me that like when electricity was coming to the area where she was, they wired the house for electricity first. Cause you know, now when you build a house, everything is wired for electricity, you know, they had to hire someone to come and wire the house for electricity. And they wired the house for electricity, and it was still a year until they actually ran the lines to her area. So the house was ready for electricity a year in advance. But they didn't have indoor plumbing. They didn't have running water in the house.
Right.
No electricity, you know, and that's just normal shit, you know.
Yeah.
And during the Depression, you know, because they were farmers, like, her family was okay as far as food because they had hogs and chickens and grew their own food and stuff, you know. Mm-hmm. But like people, she would tell me about all the people that didn't live on a farm, how rough it was on them, you know. It's very, very interesting, you know, hearing her talk about just, it's a totally different way of life.
Have you released those?
Mm-mm, no, I'm going through them and I'm going to write about her in the new book.
Okay. You know? Yeah. That's awesome. That's so killer that you got the opportunity to do that.
Yeah. And I encourage people. And that's when I would post pictures every time I visit my grandma, because, you know, I was trying to encourage people to go and visit their old people, you know, and do it now because we get so busy in our lives, right. You know, and like, my grandma died, you know, right before this tour, basically. And that whole generation, that chapter of my family, that book is closed now. Like, there's no one left. She was the last one, over 100 years old.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, what a life, though. Jesus.
Yeah. Really incredible life. So, like I like was trying to get as much as I could out of her before she left us, you know, just to know this shit. Because soon there's not going to be anyone alive that remembers a time before electricity.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
Those people are gone.
Yeah.
You know? She's one of the last. So she was 100 and a half when she died.
You said she was pretty cognizant, like all the way through to the end, too, right? Which is, that's amazing.
Yeah.
That doesn't
know. Her memory was shot by the end. But she wasn't like, she didn't think she was like in England or a different person. It wasn't,
she recognized
like, all,
you.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Like, yeah. She knew like, but she, her memory was going more and more and more, but she still knew who we were, you know, like, so she was there. It's just like her memory was going. So, and I watched that happen, you know, slowly. And then, the last 3 weeks of her life, you know, I was with her basically every day, you know, and if it wasn't me, it was another family member. And yeah, I was with her when she died, you know, so that was really important to me. It was my ship and I got to be there and just, you know, let her know she wasn't alone.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Some people are afraid of death, I think, but like that used to be the normal thing. You know, people weren't in hospitals when they died. They were at home and family members were around them.
Right.
That's the old school way. And people now, I think, are so afraid of like, not just, I think that's why so many people get all this fucking crazy plastic surgery and shit. They're trying to push away old age. They're trying to fight their mortality, you know? Like they're trying to pursue some sort of foolish eternal youth, you know, and it's an idiotic pursuit because we're all going to die.
Yeah.
So you might as well make peace with it, you know?
Yeah. I love that you interviewed your grandma. I mean, I think that's so cool. I did that to my dad, actually. I interviewed my dad.
I'm going to do that with my dad and my mom soon, you know, cause they're in their 70s.
Yeah. My dad's 80, he's 84. So, and this is a while ago. I want to say this was like 8 years ago. I never did anything. I just was recorded it and I just interviewed him and I got him to talk about
yeah.
his life. And, you know, he was born, I guess it was the World War II was going on.
Right.
And so, but his family was dirt poor. I mean, like I grew up 3 blocks away from the trailer park that he grew up in. And so like we would walk by there when I was a kid and he would show me like, yeah, this is where I grew up. He grew up in a aluminum, like one of those aluminum trailers that you tow on the back of a car.
Sure.
That was five people living in that. And they were living in a trailer park, you know, no running water. If you had to take a shit, you shit in a bucket and then took it over to the hole, which was like a quarter mile away, like at
yeah.
the end of the trailer park, and then dumped your bucket into the fucking hole or whatever the fuck it was.
Yeah.
You know, he was like, and he tells me this and he tells me it all the time. And I can hear it when he says it, you know, he was like, when it rained, you know, you got to remember we're living in aluminum, you know, little round trailer. Like when it fucking rained, it was the loudest fucking sound. It just and five people are like trying to sleep and I gotta get up, and you know, his mom's an alcoholic, so he's like, I gotta steal money from my mom so that she doesn't go buy booze with it so that we can eat later on that night. And like just this whole, I mean, it was this crazy fucking life. And like, I don't know, like I want to write a book about his life just because it's
yeah.
one of the most interesting fucking lives I've ever, I mean, it's just insane. It's fucking insane. And, but yeah, like, you know, I only talked to him about 45 minutes to an hour. You know, I feel like what you did was probably a lot more, you know, in depth, and you probably got a lot more, you know, of
yeah. I started off asking her, you know, her birth date and where she was born and all that stuff. And then I asked her earliest memories. And then from there, it just, you know, went through her childhood all the way up until. So it was an interesting experience, man. You know, yeah. And some of the stories I'd heard before and some of them I hadn't. So it was really cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
I encourage anyone to go interview their old people.
Yeah.
You know,
right.
And go do it now before it's too late. Because, like at the end, like when her memory was going, like I couldn't get any more stories out of her,
right.
you know, because she just couldn't remember. So do it before it's too late, people.
Do you have kids?
No.
No kids? So you're not going to have a son who can interview you when you're old?
Nah, I don't think so.
Yeah. I guess we'll have your Instagram page.
Yeah, you'll have my music, we'll my books, music,
your books. Yeah,
the world can only handle one of me. You know what I'm saying? There's enough humans.
Totally. Well, dude, this has been an awesome conversation, man.
Yeah, dude. Great. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's been fucking great.
I'm gonna make some tea now.
Best of luck for the rest of the tour. You going into Thanks, Canada buddy. Now pretty soon? Are you in Canada? No, pretty soon?
We're in Jersey. We end in Canada.
Okay.
Yeah. So let's hope we can get over the border.
Right. Right. You know. Dude, you guys have done this whole tour and not gotten coronavirus. I think this might be the first tour that I've all the tours that, you know, Monkey got fucking coronavirus. Jonathan Davis got coronavirus. The fucking, you know, well, so many fucking, you know, every band that went out, like,
knock on wood. Yeah. You know, we're just wearing masks. I'm wearing masks backstage. You know, we're not like partying with the other bands. It's weird.
Right.
You know, it must be weird, but
some of that camaraderie that you might normally have.
Yeah. I mean, but like, you know, I take food from catering. I don't eat in catering.
Okay.
You know, we hang on our bus or in our dressing room and they're just trying to maintain this thing. I test pretty often, you know, like if it's available at the venue, I'll take a test.
Yeah.
Cause I'm trying to be responsible, man. You know, I don't want to get, no matter what anybody's beliefs are, you know, I don't want to get anyone else sick.
Yeah.
You know, that is me. That is what I have to say. That is for me. I cannot speak for anyone else, period. But for me, I'm trying to be responsible and as I see fit, according to my moral compass, which I'm trying to keep calibrated correctly to the best of my ability.
Yeah,
you know, and that's the only thing, that's all I can do is control myself. I have zero control over anyone else.
Yeah,
anyone in the world. There's one person I can control their actions. That person is D. Randall Blythe.
Yeah, well, I wanted to thank you for the long text you sent me back then. I ended up going sober for a year after that.
Shock up.
Yeah, I drink now, but I only drink like Friday and Saturday with my wife. Just kick it in the backyard. And
so you're not like me. See, and not everybody has to be totally sober. That's the whole thing. It's like, I'm not like, you have to quit drinking. It's like, once again, I deal with one person, me. Right. That's it. And I can only worry about my problem.
Right.
You know, so, you know, I know for me, it's not a good idea.
Yeah.
You know, it's just not a good idea. So, and I, you know, I'm not saying I'll never drink again because I don't have a crystal fucking ball, but I worry about one day at a time. And for the rest of the day, I think I'm going to make it. I think I'm going to be all right there, Rob.
Yeah. You're going to be all right, Randy Blythe. You are, man.
I'm going to try.
You, Randall Blythe.
Yeah, bud.
This is the epic one, dude. 2 hours and 10 minutes. Fuck
yeah. Man.
Thank you for giving me so much of your time, dude.
No worry. I'm sure that the clickbait aggregators will get plenty of fucking dipshit headlines out of it.
Yeah. Well, if anybody bothers to click on the interview, they'll get a fan fucking tastic interview. So
yeah, so kick back and listen, you know,
hell
it's
yeah.
All good. Have a conversation.
Ladies and gentlemen, right there, the mighty, mighty D. Randall Blythe, Lamb of God.
With Robb Flynn.